we present Graham Crowden as Austin Ruthin and Teresa Gallagher as his daughter Maud in Uncle Silas by Sheridan Lefanu.
She won't understand. No, she won't, will she?
It was the year 1864, a bleak November evening.
They are easily frightened. Aye, they are.
I had just turned my 17th birthday.
I had better do it another way. Another way, yes. And she'll not suspect. She'll not suppose.
My father had summoned me to his study.
You remark how solitary we live.
Sir?
You fancy perhaps I have no friend. You are nearly right. Nearly, but not altogether.
Sir?
I have a very sure friend. One, a friend whom I once misunderstood, but now appreciate.
I am glad to hear it, sir.
Glad to hear it. She is glad to hear it. He'll make me a call someday soon. I'm not quite sure when.
How shall I know it?
I won't tell you his name. You'll hear that soon enough. I don't want it talked of.
Sir?
I must make a little journey with him.
What kind of journey?
I have a journey, sir, shortly to go. My master calls me. I must not say no. You'll not be afraid being left alone for a while.
Have you promised, sir?
Promised? No, child. I'm under condition. He's not to be denied. I have no choice, Maud. But, on the whole, I rather like it. I rather like it.
Sir?
See, child, remember this key.
The key, sir?
It opens this. You won't forget this cabinet. Oak, near the door. You won't forget.
Why, sir, you're hurting.
Pity she's a girl, aye, a girl, and so young. No sense. Giddy. Say you'll remember.
I'll remember.
It behoves you.
You're hurting.
I did not mean... You will tell nobody what I have said.
Oh, no, sir.
Except under one contingency. If I should be absent and a Dr. Brierly... Repeat the name.
Dr. Brierly.
If he should come and inquire for the key and what it opens, you show all to him. You show all to him and no one else.
But when he comes, you will be absent.
That is so.
Then how shall I find the key?
When I sleep, the key is under my pillow. You hear me?
Yes, sir.
And when I am awake, it is always here, in my pocket.
But you will be absent.
Always here, in my pocket.
You must not judge my father by his manner. My mother had died when I was 9, and as a result he had largely withdrawn from society, immersing himself in his own company. Yet underneath he was the gentlest and kindest of men.
How long is it since Miss Ellerton left us?
6 months, sir.
This won't do. Too long without a teacher.
Yes, sir.
Your French is pretty well and you're Italian, but I fear they grow rusty.
I have tried to keep in practice.
Your music may be pretty good. I'm no judge of that, but your drawing might be better.
I fear you are correct.
I believe there are accomplished ladies, finishing governesses, they call them. They undertake more than any teacher could in my time and do very well. You shall have one. She will prepare you, and then you shall visit France and Italy. There you may be as accomplished as you please.
Thank you, sir.
My brother has suggested...
Uncle Silas, you have been in communication with him?
It is no matter. You shall have a finishing governess.
Uncle Silas. Some time previously, I had been looking at some portraits in the Long Gallery.
Is this not Uncle Silas?
Yes, dear.
He must be a very handsome man.
Oh, he was, my dear, yes. But it's 40 years since that was painted. 40 years, I can tell you, makes a change in the best of us.
And why is Papa always so sad about Uncle Silas?
Is he sad?
Well, I have seen him so.
Maybe he has reason.
Mrs. Rusk?
Yes, dear?
Have you met my uncle?
Many years ago.
What was he like?
What's this, child?
I'm sorry, sir. I didn't know you was there.
I'm sure I meant no...
No harm, child. No harm. Your uncle is a man of great talents, great faults and great wrongs. His talents have not availed him. His faults are long ago repented of, and his wrongs, I believe, he feels less than I do. But they are deep. They are deep. Mrs. Rusk.
Sir?
Have you told my daughter any more than this?
Not even this, sir.
Maud, you should think more of the present.
Should I, sir?
Clear your head of Uncle Silas. One day, perhaps, you will know him and how villains have wronged him.
But I could not clear my head of Uncle Silas. However, from that day, neither Mrs. Rusk nor any other of the household would speak of him. Towards the middle of that November, I chanced upon Mrs. Rusk carrying fresh bedding.
Is someone coming to stay?
Yes, dear.
Is it someone I know?
Oh, I should doubt it. He's to have dinner with your father and may stay for some days.
You sound as if you disapprove of him.
It's not for me to approve or disapprove. Dr. Brierly.
Dr. Brierly?
You do know him?
I am not acquainted with him. When does Dr. Brierly arrive?
This afternoon.
He's here, isn't he?
He's with your father in his study.
I should like to see him.
What's come over you, dear?
I would like to.
You will in time.
I would like to see him now. I must confess, I am impatient.
Oh, what's got into you? Oh, here's a carafe of water. See if the one in your father's study needs replenishing. Oh,
thank you, Mrs. Rusk.
As I walked down the passage, I wondered what sort of man I was about to meet.
I strongly advise you against this course of action.
My mind is made up.
My father and Dr. Brierly were arguing.
I must insist.
My mind is made up.
I hesitated, moved closer, and listened.
What you are proposing is folly.
It is a public statement of trust.
It could so easily rebound against...
It is the good name of the family. Come in.
I wondered, sir, if you needed water.
That is very thoughtful of you, child, but no, we do not require water.
This is your daughter, Maud?
This is my daughter, Maud.
I look forward to making your acquaintance.
I look forward to making yours, sir.
Now, leave us. We have business to discuss.
Yes, sir.
You cannot be prepared to sacrifice your only...
I must ask you not to comment on what you do not understand.
Dr. Brierly departed the next day, but my state of perturbation remained.
You cannot be prepared to sacrifice your only...
My somewhat ancient maid, Mary Quince, whose bed was in my room, could not help but notice my mood.
Is anything the matter?
Nothing, Mary.
You're awake.
Yes, Mary.
And have been off and on these last few nights.
I hope I have not prevented you from sleeping.
Tell me what it is.
It is nothing. I have a sense of unease.
What kind of unease?
As if something were about to happen.
What kind of thing?
I can't tell.
It is nothing.
It doesn't feel as if it is
nothing. Let's talk a little. Then you'll see that it is nothing. What do you want to talk about?
Anything, anything.
Oh, go on, then.
Have you heard of Rachel Ruthin?
I cannot recall her.
She was a daughter of the house in Queen Anne's time.
Oh, I think I have some...
They say she walks the passages at night. The click, click, click of her shoes on the floor, the rustle of her skirts and a broken sigh.
The girl's been dead this 150 years.
You do know about her. Let us see if we can hear.
Miss Maud.
You stay in bed.
You're frightening me.
I shall open the door. Listen.
You're catch cold.
You made me jump.
You're young, you're... prey to fancies.
I'm being foolish.
Close the door and get back in your bed.
Yes, Mary.
What is it?
Listen.
Close the door. Close the door. It's gone.
I shall open the door.
No, don't.
Nothing. Nobody.
Good morning, child.
Good morning, sir.
You will recall I mentioned a finishing governess.
Yes, sir.
She has been engaged. She arrived here at Knoll last evening. I am allowing her today to settle in, and she will commence her duties tomorrow morning. You will be in the schoolroom at 9 o'clock sharp.
Yes, sir.
She is called Madame de la Rougière.
Will I like her as much as Miss Ellerton?
You must like people for what they are, and not how they compare to others.
And what are you called? What is Mademoiselle's name?
Maud, Madame.
Maud. What a pretty name. I am very sure my dear Maud will be a very good little girl. I am also very sure we will come to like each other very much.
I very much hope so, Madame.
And what have you been learning, my dear child? Music, French, Italian, eh?
Yes, a little. I had just begun the use of the globes when Miss Ellerton went away.
Oh, yes, the globes. Observe how they rotate. Je vous expliquerai tout cela au fond.
However, explaining was not one of Madame's strengths.
No, no, no!
Perhaps if you were to go over it again...
What is the point? Why should I bother? You are just stupid, stupid, and that is the end of it.
I'm sorry, Madame, if I could just...
A stupid little child. There now. You have upset your dear Madame. No matter. She forgives you.
We gradually became acquainted.
Good morning, my dear child.
Good morning, Madame.
I hope you have not been waiting for long.
I've been reading.
I hope it was instructive.
Are you unwell?
I am fatigued. You also have stomach pains.
I could get Branston to send to the village for the...
It is an old trouble. I have asked my dear friend Mrs. Rusk to fetch me the remedy. So, what have you been reading?
History, Madame.
History is always instructive. We have not touched on it yet. How far have you got? The history of your country is so interesting.
Henry the Fifth, Madame. Perhaps you could tell me...
No, dear child, I'm sure the book is far more... Oh, Mrs. Rusk.
Madame.
You have brought the medicine.
I have indeed.
Well?
Here are some soothing pills and a mustard plaster. I would advise you to take the first and apply the second.
That is not what I requested.
I have found them a sovereign remedy against stomach pains.
I know what is good for me.
I am not bringing you brandy.
And why not? I have requested it.
I do not serve liquor to domestics.
It was Madame's responsibility to see I took daily exercise in the grounds.
This way, my dear Maud.
I don't wish to go into the wood, Madame.
And why is that?
Mama is buried there.
That is where the vault is?
Yes.
What a curious reason. Your dear mother is buried there, therefore you do not wish to approach it. Whatever would Monsieur Rutin say?
I mean, I would rather go there by myself.
I have a taste for the company of the dead. I feel comfortable in their presence. Un goût bizarre, vraiment. Come, let us go, if only part of the way. How noble. How sad. My dear child, do read me the inscription.
Hic jacet Elizabeth Huntercombe, 1822 to 1856. Dearly beloved wife of Austin and mother of Maud. She has gone before to show the way.
Such admirable sentiments.
Madame, you are mocking me.
How many Rutins must be buried here within this temple? Tell me, do you think your house of Knoll is haunted?
What makes you ask that?
The servants say...
The servants will say.
Have you seen a ghost yourself? I have.
I saw one last night. It was shaped like a monkey, sitting in a corner with its arms round its knees. It had the face of an old man, a very wicked old man, and its eyes gleamed like this.
You are trying to frighten me.
Let us talk of something else.
Yes, let's.
What a good man your father is.
The kindest darling. I don't know why it is, madame. I can never tell him how much I love him.
Was there not a doctor with him just before I arrived?
Yes, Dr. Briley. Shall we go back towards the house?
Does your father suffer much?
Suffer? No, I think not.
Then what is his disease?
He has no disease. Madame, have you heard...
But surely if a doctor comes...
I think Dr. Briley is a doctor of theology. He is a Swedenborgian.
Swedenborgian? Your father is much taken with Swedenborgianism. It is unusual for a man as old as your father to have a child as young as you.
Madame, I do not think that...
Has he made his will, my dear? A man as old, as rich as he, ought to have made his will.
There's no need of haste, madame.
Has he really not made his will?
I really don't know.
You are teasing me, you little rogue. You pretend you know nothing. Tell me all about it. What does his will say?
Madame, I don't even know if there is one.
What is he frightened of? Does Monsieur Tutin think signing his will brings him, letter by letter, closer to the grave? If he has not made one, you could lose a lot of property.
If Papa has made a will, he has never spoken of it to me. I know he loves me. That is enough.
Come, come, you little goose. If you won't tell, I'll break your little finger.
Oh, madame, you're being childish.
Break your little finger. Like this twig. Like this. Tell. So, tell me.
Oh, yes. Yes, I'll tell. Let me go.
So, you're going to be a good child and tell your affectionate governess everything.
No. No, I won't. You can't make me.
Why, you little...
You hurt me. You've broken my finger.
Nonsense. Rub it and blow it and give it a little kiss.
I shall inform my father.
What a stupid child. I will never play a game with it again. Never.
You wanted to see me, sir?
Yes, Maud. It is a serious matter.
I'm sorry to hear it.
Earlier this morning, I was visited by Madame de la Rosière. She had come to borrow some works by Swedenborg.
I did not know she was religiously inclined.
It does not suit you to be impertinent.
No, sir.
I asked her as to your progress. I asked her, pray mark that. She did not volunteer the subject.
I trust her report was favourable.
It was not.
Of what was she complaining?
I think you know.
I do not.
I find that rather hard to credit.
If you wish to take her word rather than mine...
I find your manner confirms what Madame was saying.
I would ask you, sir, to detail her accusations.
I do not wish to be drawn into discussing details.
I must protest. I, too, have...
You ought not to give Madame so much pain. She is one of the few persons who takes an interest in you. Why should she be subject to your ill temper and disobedience? Why should she be compelled to ask my permission to punish you? Oh, don't be afraid, I won't concede that. However, it argues much she felt compelled to ask. Affection I cannot command, respect and obedience I may, and I insist on you rendering both to Madame. You look as though you are about to cry.
I am not, sir.
There, there, little Maud. Enough. Come here. There is no need to be upset. Only let us do better in the future.
One day, Madame proposed a longer walk than usual, out of the grounds, to Church Scarsdale.
But why Church Scarsdale?
It is such a pretty name.
It is not a pretty place, Madame. Nobody lives there, and the church is in ruins.
Then I shall like it the better.
I can suggest far pleasanter
ways. We will go there. I insist.
There is the church, on the other side.
As you said, it is in ruins. And look at the graves.
I do not like this place.
How many of them are there?
I do not intend to stand here counting tombstones.
Then let us go amongst
them. No!
Let us lie between them half an hour. You know my pleasure in these things.
It is unhealthy.
Come with me, dear child. Dear child.
I don't understand your insistence.
My insistence?
I will stay here. You may go if you wish.
Very well. I will go by myself. I will not be long. You will stay here.
Yes, I will.
You will not move. I should hate to lose you. You will stay here.
It began to grow dark.
I say, miss, no offence. Have you seen a glove close by here?
A glove?
Yeah, I was here earlier and I dropped a glove. Might you have seen it?
No, sir.
No offence, miss, but you sure you didn't hide it?
I should like you to leave me, sir.
Don't be frightened, miss. It's only a bit of chaff. I'm not going to search you.
Madame! Madame!
Madame! Madame! Oh, my, you are agitated. Madame! Madame! Oi! Madame! That's all she's done as a tombstone. Now, give her my compliments and say I said you're a beauty, miss.
There was nothing to be frightened of. He was just passing.
Possibly.
Doesn't your madame always know best?
Probably.
Eh bien. There is a lady coming tomorrow, is there not?
Lady Knollys.
Lady Knollys? What an odd name. She is very young, is she not?
Past 50, I think.
She is very old, then. Is she rich?
I don't know. She has a place in Derbyshire.
And is she your relation?
Papa's first cousin.
And for how long, dear, will Lady Knollys remain?
A very few days, I believe.
I would so like to be presented to her.
I have no doubt you will.
But alas, I have a pain in my ear. I can feel it growing. I know it will get worse. I may have to forego the pleasure.
My young cousin. You know who I am? Your cousin Monica. Monica Knollys. And very glad, dear, to see you. I haven't set eyes on you since you were no bigger than that paper knife.
I am very glad to meet you, Lady Knollys.
Oh, what a serious little body. Now turn towards the light, for I must look at you. Well, Austin.
Yes, Monica?
Now let me see.
I'd rather think...
Don't be shy, my dear. Let me see. Upon my life, something of your mother and not a bit like you, Austin.
So much the better, Monica, eh?
Cousin, I...
No, your papa was and will be ugly all his days. But those eyes... The true grey, large, deep, soft, very peculiar. Just like her mother, eh, Austin?
Yes, Monica. I had observed.
My father retired to his study, leaving my cousin and me alone.
Come here, my dear, and tell me how you and your papa get on. I can remember him quite a cheerful man once, and now you see how he is, all by shutting himself up and nursing his whims and fancies.
Cousin?
Monica?
Monica, I don't think it's proper talking about...
You know, my dear, your father is an oddity. I don't mind him, I never did. You must not. Cracky, my dear. Cracky, decidedly cracky. Oh, I see, I alarm you. I'll change the subject. Do you have... anyone looking after you?
Oh, yes. I have a governess, a French woman, a Madame de la Rougière.
And who sent her?
I really don't know. Papa tells me so little. He arranged it all himself, I think, although he did mention my uncle.
Your Uncle Silas?
Yes, that's right.
Your Uncle Silas sent this French woman?
I don't know. I couldn't ascertain.
And what does she do, this Madame de la Rougière? Come, let us visit Madame. I should so like to talk to her a little.
But she is ill.
Ill, is she? What's the matter?
The earache, she says.
The earache. Is she up or in her bed?
In her room, but not in bed.
Pain in her ear, you say? Poor thing. Well, dear, I think I can cure that in 5 minutes. I have it myself now and then. Come to my room and we'll get the bottles.
We'll come in, please, and see you. I've some remedies which I'm sure will do you good.
Perhaps she's asleep.
Madame, it is Maud and Lady Knollys. We have come to relieve your ear. Pray, let me see it. She can't be asleep. She's holding the clothes so fast over her head.
Je suis fatiguée.
Do pray allow me to see it.
What?
Maud, the covers.
Ugh.
Oh, so, this is Madame de la Rougière. Mademoiselle, you have married, it seems, since last I had the honour of seeing you.
Yes, I am married. Very respectably married for a person of my rank. I shall not need to be a governess for long.
I suppose you have explained everything satisfactorily to Mr. Ruffin.
I fail to see I should explain a marriage.
That is not what I meant.
There is nothing to explain. I am ready to answer any questions. Let him demand me.
Very good, mademoiselle.
Madame, if you please.
Madame, yes. I shall inform him of my suspicions concerning you.
Suspicions?
So far as I can see, mademoiselle, your ear doesn't seem to trouble you now.
Malady is a physic in itself. I am only a poor governess, and such people ought not to have pain.
Come, Maud. Let us leave the invalid to her repose. I don't think she needs my chloroform and opium at the moment.
Her room smells of brandy, my dear. Does she drink?
What?
Oh, you look amazed. Such things are known to happen. How long have you had that woman?
A little over 6 weeks.
And what sort of person is she? Do you like her?
Very well. That is, pretty well. You won't tell. I'm sure she doesn't intend it, but she rather frightens me.
She does not beat you?
No.
She does not threaten you?
Well, no. No, she does not threaten.
Then how the plague does she frighten you, child?
Well, I really... I'm half ashamed to tell you. You'll laugh at me, but... There is something... Is there not something, you know, ghosty about her?
Ghosty, is there? Well, I'm sure I don't know, but I suspect there's something devilish.
You knew Madame before. Who is she?
She assures me she is Madame de la Rougière, and I suppose she has every right to do so. I do remember her face, and I don't very much like it. And you may depend upon it, I will speak to your father about her, and don't, darling, ask me any more about her, for I have really not very much to tell you that you will care to hear, and the fact is, I won't say any more about her. There. Come in.
Oh, thank you, ma'am. Some tea, ma'am.
And who is this?
It's Mary Quince.
Mary Quince?
Yes, ma'am.
You wait on my little cousin, don't you?
Yes, ma'am.
Put it down.
Thank you, ma'am.
Does anyone sleep in her room?
Yes, I please, my lady.
And no one else?
No, ma'am.
And not even the governess sometimes?
Oh, no, please, my lady.
Never, you are quite sure?
Oh, no, never.
Thank you, Maud. I like your face, Mary Quince. I'm very glad, Maud, you have got her. So, ghosties and goblins, eh? Well, if I were you, Maud, I know what I would do. So soon as I and good Mary Quince had got into my bedchamber for the night, I should stir the fire into a good blaze and bolt the door.
You are not suggesting that...
Do you hear, Mary Quince? Bolt the door and keep the candle lighted all night. You be very attentive to her, Mary Quince, and I shall be sending a little Christmas box to my cousin, and I shan't forget you.
Thank you, ma'am.
You may go. Now, let us think of more pleasant things.
Yes.
Let us pour the tea.
That evening, my cousin asked to see the portrait of Uncle Silas in the Long Gallery.
This was 40 years ago.
So manly. They're so slender and so handsome, too. I always think him a hero and a mystery. They won't tell me about him, so I can only dream and wonder.
A mystery but no hero, my dear Maud. I don't know what to make of him. He is a sort of idol of your father's. His abilities were singular, as were his misfortunes.
Tell me.
Your Uncle Silas, you know, is living.
Oh, yes, at Bartram Howe in Derbyshire.
You know how rich your father is. Silas was the younger brother and had little more than 1,000 a year. He was fond of his pleasures, I suppose. I believe he was really a most expensive and vicious young man. I fancy he does not deny that now, for they say he would change the past if he could. Austin, your papa, was very kind to Silas and paid a great number of his debts. However, he never forgave your uncle his marriage. Your father, I suppose, knew more about the lady than I did, but there were various reports, none of them pleasant, and she was not visited. There was a complete estrangement between Austin and Silas, but it was made up, rather oddly, on the very occasion that ought to have totally separated them.
I'm afraid I don't understand.
Did you ever hear anything remarkable about your uncle?
No, never. No one would tell me the slightest thing.
It has to be acknowledged, your Uncle Silas was suspected of committing a murder.
Of course, Uncle Silas, of course he's innocent.
Of course, my dear. But there are some things it is almost as bad to be suspected of as actually to have done. Your papa, you know, is very proud of your family. He never had the slightest suspicion of your uncle.
Oh, no.
He tried to get redress through the courts, but was advised against it. He also tried to use his political influence to clear his brother's name, but to no avail. Indeed, his lack of success is one of the main reasons for his withdrawal from society.
And Uncle Silas?
Your father made him an additional annuity of £500 and allows him to live at Bartram Howe, which is part of your father's estate. They say it has become very wild and neglected.
You live in the same county. Have you seen it lately, Cousin Monica?
No, not lately.
The next morning, Madame was not in the schoolroom. I went up to her room and was about to knock on her door.
What do you mean, dear child, standing with your hand in the air?
Good morning, Madame.
Why could not Lady Knollys come herself to listen at the keyhole? What is there to conceal? Nothing. Enter, if you please. Everyone is welcome. It is Liberty Hall.
I did not come, Madame, to pry or intrude.
But did she not send you, Doucement, so quiet at my door? She is my enemy, without cause, but my enemy. She has tried to injure me on several occasions and uses the most innocent person, my dear, to further her malice.
Lady Knollys is Papa's cousin.
Et comment va monsieur votre père aujourd'hui?
Très bien, merci.
I will go to speak to him. I will endure her torment no longer.
I ought to have heard of this before, madame.
I am sorry, monsieur.
Not that it would have made any difference, not the least. Mark that.
Thank you, monsieur.
But it was the kind of thing I ought to have heard, and the omission was not strictly right. Come in. What do you want, child?
Only that I was waiting in the schoolroom for madame and did not know where she was.
Well, she is here, as you see, and will join you upstairs in the schoolroom in a few moments.
Yes, sir.
But you did know where I was, dear child. I told you.
That evening I was playing the piano. My father and cousin assumed I could not hear them.
Yes, Lady Knollys, there is an animus.
An animus?
I know the spirit you speak in. It does you no honour.
And I know the spirit you speak in. The spirit of madness. Are you blind?
You are, Monica. Your unnatural prejudices blind you.
It is surely clear to the merest...
What is all this? Nothing. Were I to act as you say, I should be a coward and a traitor.
There should be no halting here. How can you? Do you ever think? I feel as if the evil one were in the house. You open your door in the dark and invoke unknown danger. How can you look at that child? She is... She stopped playing.
Perhaps, Monica, you would come to the study. I thank you for your concern, but you must see things more rationally, and I think you will.
We will come back.
Monica!
Where is Papa?
He has remained in his study. I'm going in the morning.
So soon?
Yes, dear. I could not stay. In fact, I should have gone tonight, but it was too late.
I am so sorry.
So am I, dear Maud. Your papa and I, we've had a quarrel. I must say a word to you before I go, and it is this. You must cease to be a mere child and try to be a woman.
What do you mean?
That creature, what does she call herself, Rougier? I have reason to believe is, must be your enemy. You will find her deep, daring, and unscrupulous. You cannot be too much on your guard. Do you quite understand me, Maud?
I do.
You must hold your tongue, govern your conduct, and command even your features. Try and be in appearance just as usual. If you happen to know anything of your father's business, tell her nothing. Observe everything, disclose nothing. Do you see?
I do.
You have good, honest servants about you, thank God. They don't like her. Write to me whenever you wish. If I can be of any real use, I don't care. I'll come. Do you understand me?
Yes, Cousin Monica, I do.
And Maud, don't let her tamper with your food.
I took Cousin Monica's words to heart. However, Madame's behaviour gave no cause for alarm. Then one morning, towards the end of January, I was in my room preparing to go for a walk.
Come in.
Miss Maud, is it not too far for you? It's a long walk to Church Scarsdale and the weather is still bitter.
Church Scarsdale? I'm not going to Church Scarsdale. Who said I was going to Church Scarsdale? Oh,
Madame's been downstairs at me for fruit and sandwiches, telling me you were longing to go to Church Scarsdale.
It's quite untrue. She knows I hate it.
She does she? Now, what may she be after?
I can't tell, but I won't go.
We walked in the grounds.
What is that carriage doing?
How should I know, dear child?
Ask them, madame, whether they want to go to the house. I dare say they've missed their way.
Then they can find it again. I do not intend to talk to strangers.
Do you want to reach the house?
No, thank you, miss. It's what they call a picnic. We'll be taking the road now.
Come, enough of this nonsense.
This is private property. You have no permission to
Hello, how's this?
Who have we here?
Sorry to startle you, ladies, creeping up on you.
We're just in time, eh? 5 more minutes and we've been off.
Thanks, Mrs. Mouser, for the honour of this meeting.
Mrs. Mouser is not my name.
And in particular for making the acquaintance of the young lady, niece, ma'am, daughter, granddaughter, badger.
We have no time.
Boy, a couple of glasses and a bottle of croissant.
I'm not your boy.
This is Lord Lollipop, regular charmer, won't hurt a fly.
Yes, pleased to make your acquaintance.
And I'm Sir Simon Sugarstick. I'm sweet all through.
Tell them I'm Miss Ruthen. Tell them.
Be quiet. They are tipsy. Leave me to speak. Pray, gentlemen, what do you want? Will you have the goodness to permit us to go on?
No. We will not have the goodness to permit you to go on.
It's him.
What do you mean?
The man at Church Scarsdale.
No.
Let's run.
Calm yourself.
I'll tell you what. We've caught you now. Fair game. And we'll let you off on condition. Now, what should the condition be, Lolly, old boy?
The condition should be that you step into the carriage over there and take a glass of Curacao just with us.
Well, that's easy for you. We'll all have a glass in the carriage and so part friends. Is it a bargain?
Yes, Maud, we must go with
you. No, you won't let us down.
What does it matter?
I shan't.
You're coming with us.
Don't touch me.
I'll lift it.
But let me go.
You fool, Maud.
I've got it.
Oh, do as they say.
Help!
Quiet.
No, less of that.
They won't hurt.
What's going on over there?
Over here! Help!
Gamekeepers!
There's more than one of them! Come on!
Over here!
Au secours! Au secours!
They away.
What a little fool you were. You were quite safe with me, but no, you would scream and shove, and the impudence and violence followed. You are a stupid, stupid fool.
Mary Quince, are you there?
Yes, Miss Maud.
Did you hear what she said?
She isn't worth thinking about.
Do you think she knew?
Knew what, Miss Maud?
Do you think Madame knew of those dreadful people? Why did she say we were going to Church Scarsdale? Tell me she didn't know. Tell me she didn't. I couldn't bear it if she did.
That night I could not sleep. The events of the day had given me a feeling of impending crisis.
Mary, are you awake? Mary? Click, click, click.
It must be. It must be.
Silently, I opened the door and followed the noise.
It was Madame.
It must be. It must be in here, in the study. In the desk. Yes, the desk. Yes. The key. The key. Here.
Oh, sir, you don't know what a dreadful person we have living with us. Madame de la Rogière, I mean. Don't let her in if she comes. She would guess that I'm telling you, and one way or another, I am sure she would kill me.
Tut, tut, child. You know that's nonsense.
But I saw it, Papa. She stole your key last night and opened your desk and went through your papers.
Stole my key? Stole it? Why, here it is.
She unlocked your desk. She searched through it. She was looking for something. Open it now and see whether your papers have not been stirred.
Did she remove anything?
No.
You're a good girl, Maud. You have not been very happy with Madame de la Rougierre. It is time you were relieved. This occurrence decides it. She will be here in a moment. I had asked to interview her further about what happened yesterday.
I can't face her.
There is no need to be frightened. Act discreetly. Sit and say nothing. Come in.
Good morning, Monsieur Routin.
Good morning, Madame.
Good morning, Maud.
Madame de la Rougierre, I have to request you to give me the key, now in your possession, which unlocks this desk of mine.
I cannot comprehend, Monsieur Routin, unless you intend to insult me.
It won't do, Madame. I must have that false key.
But who dares to say I possess such a thing?
You know, Madame, you can rely on what I say. I tell you, you were seen last night visiting this room with a key in your possession, opening this desk and going through the papers contained in it. If you will forthwith give me that key and any other false keys in your possession, I shall content myself with dismissing you summarily. If you do not, I shall take a different course. You know I am a magistrate. I shall have you, your boxes and your places upstairs searched, and I will prosecute you criminally. The thing is clear. You aggravate by denying. You must give me that key instantly, otherwise I ring this bell.
I will do anything, Monsieur Routin. Whatever you wish.
Thank you. You shall have an hour and a half to prepare in. You must then be ready to depart.
I had no desire to make final fond farewells with Madame, so I went for a walk.
La 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 la.
So, always frightened, Maud, and with reason. Do not think I do not realize all I have to thank you for.
I will tell him.
I am to go to London first and abroad, but be sure, my sweetest Maud, wherever I may be, I shall remember you.
I have nothing to say to you.
And although I shall not always be near, I shall know everything about my dearest child, and you won't know how.
Leave me.
The carriage is waiting at the yew tree stile. You did not expect to see me here. I will appear, perhaps suddenly, another time. Farewell, my dearest little Maud. I will never cease to think of you.
And you, I think, will never cease to think of me.
You have more interest now than I have in vindicating his character.
Whose character, sir? My father often assumed I would know what he was thinking about, although he had given no sign.
Whose? Your Uncle Silas. In the course of nature, he must survive me. He will represent the family name. Would you make some sacrifice to clear that name, Maud?
You have no need to ask, sir. It was now early March in the year 1865.
Your Uncle Silas lies under an intolerable slander. He has grown religious, and that's well, but he bears it with an apathy that is mistaken. The character and influence of an ancient family are a peculiar heritage, sacred but destructible, and woe to him who either destroys or suffers it to perish. Well, Maud, in the course of a few weeks, and it may be sooner, I shall embark on my journey.
Sir, must you go?
I must. You shall promise me not to mention this conversation to Monica Norris. Also, don't invite her to talk to you about Uncle Silas. I have reasons. Do you quite understand my conditions?
Yes, I do.
Yes, we will, Maud, you and I. We'll leave one proof on record, which, fairly read, will go far to answer the world.
That night, Mary and I were asleep.
What was that?
It's your father's room.
Mary! It's Mrs. Rusk! Come with me! Mrs. Rusk!
Mrs. Rusk!
Mrs. Rusk!
Mrs. Rusk! Mrs. Rusk!
Open the door! Mary!
Yes, miss?
Help me! Oh. Now! Oh. Again! Oh. Again! Oh. It won't budge!
Hold on! Mary, what is it?
Oh, Branston Dykes!
Come on, Mrs. Rusk!
It's the master!
Oh. Mary, I cannot bear to think what has happened!
We're through!
Now, Miss Maud, darling, you must go back again. 'Tisn't no place for you.
He's dead, isn't he?
Yes, he's dead.
Maud.
He had a sudden seizure and fell across the door.
Poor Papa. Leave me alone with him for a moment.
Miss Maud.
Leave me. All of you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
When I sleep, the key is under my pillow. You hear me?
Yes, sir.
And when I am awake, it is always here, in my pocket.
It must be done. Oh, Father.
Always here, in my pocket.
Here. The key. Mrs. Rusk returned and laid him out. I bade my formal farewell.
It's not him, my dear. It's not him. He's not here.
We placed notices in both the county and London press. 3 days later, Dr. Brierly arrived.
Please, sir, the young mistress, Miss Ruthin.
Aye. Hope, miss, you are pretty well.
As far as can, in the circumstances, be expected.
Quite. I have come in consequence of a solemn promise exacted by your father, for whom I cherished a warm esteem, being knit besides with him in spiritual bonds. It has been a shock to you, miss.
It has indeed, sir.
Your father said I was to receive a key from you which would open a cabinet where he placed his will.
This is the key.
I thank you.
And this is the cabinet.
We had better have the will read forthwith. Is there any gentleman, a relative or man of business near here whom you would wish to be sent for?
No, none, thank you. I have confidence in you, sir.
And you may be sure, Miss Ruthin, your confidence shall not be disappointed. We should get Grimston. For though he was not employed about this will, he has been Mr. Ruthin's solicitor for a great many years. We must have Grimston. For as I am sure you know, though it's a short will, it is a very strange one. Your father read it out to you, eh?
No, sir.
Oh. But he told you as much as relates to you and your uncle, Mr. Silas Ruthin of Bartram Howe?
No, indeed, sir.
Ah. I wish he had. Mr. Silas Ruthin is a religious man?
Oh, very.
You've seen a good deal of him?
No, I never saw him.
Huh? Odder and odder. I suppose, Miss Ruthin, 1 o'clock tomorrow would be a good hour?
Yes, Dr. Briley, the notes will be sent. I would like my cousin Lady Knollys to attend with me whilst the will is being read. I trust there would be no objections?
None in the world. One thing you must believe, Miss Ruthin. In forming the provisions of the will, I was never consulted, although I expostulated against the particular, very unusual condition it contains when I heard it. I did so strenuously, but in vain. You will please believe this. Also that I am your friend. Strenuously, but in vain.
1 o'clock the next day. Present, Miss Maud Ruthin, Lady Monica Knollys, Dr. Briley, and Mr. Grimston.
Mr. Grimston, you will please to read the will.
Thank you. It's a short will, very considering. I, Austin Aylmer Ruthin, being of sound mind and perfect recollection, etc., 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 hereby bequeath all my estates real, chattels real, copyrights, leases, chattels, money, rights, interests, reversions, powers, plate, pictures and estates and whatsoever, to these four persons. Lord Ilbury, Mr. Penrose Cresswell of Cresswell, Sir William Aylmer, Bart, and Hans Emmanuel Briley, Doctorate of Theology. To have and to hold, etc., etc., etc.
Is this correct?
Four trustees, madam. We take little but trouble, you'll see. Go on.
All the aforementioned to be held in trust by them for my daughter, Maud Aylmer Ruthin.
Oh.
Subject to a bequest of £15,000 to my brother, Silas Aylmer Ruthin. I also appoint Silas Aylmer Ruthin sole guardian of my daughter Maud, with full parental authority over her until she shall have reached the age of 21, up to which time she is to reside in his care at Bartram Howe. Signed and witnessed, etc., etc., etc.
Dr. Briley, pray, sir, is the reading concluded?
Concluded. Quite. Nothing more.
And to whom will the property belong in the case my little cousin here should die before she comes of age?
It would go to the heir at law and next of kin, would it not, Mr. Grimston?
That is so.
And who is that?
Why, her uncle, Mr. Silas Ruthin. He's both heir at law and next of kin.
Thank you.
Cousin Monica?
Yes, Maud?
You are dejected.
Yes, Maud.
Is it because of the will?
Don't ask her to talk to you about Uncle Silas. I have reasons.
I wish you to tell me more about Uncle Silas.
Thank you.
In part one of Uncle Silas by Sheridan Le Fanu, Maud was played by Teresa Gallagher and Austin by Graham Crowden. Madame de la Rougière, Dorothy Tutin, Lady Monica Knollys, Joan Sims, Mary Quince, Kathleen Byron, Mrs. Rusk, Tessa Worsley, Dr. Brierly, John Hartley, Dudley, Jonathan Keeble, Tom Bryce, Roger May, Mr. Grimston, Geoffrey Whitehead, the Rough Fellow, Stephen Critchlow. Other parts were played by members of the cast. The pianist was Michael Haslam. Uncle Silas was dramatized for radio by Alan Drury and directed by Enid Williams.
It was March in the year of 1865. I was 17. I sensed I was in danger.
Always frightened, Maud, and with reason.
My French governess, Madame de la Rougière, had been dismissed. I had discovered her rifling my father's desk. I now know she was seeking his will.
Farewell, my dearest little Maud. I will never cease to think of you. And you, I think, will never cease to think of me.
I had been accosted by strange men in the grounds of our house.
Don't be frightened, miss. It's only a bit of chaff.
I now realize they intended to abduct me. My father was taken from me by a seizure.
Open the door!
I can't. He's across it. Shove it. Shove it, for God's sake. I can't shift him.
Leaving me heir to the family's wealth and estates, which were substantial.
I also appoint Silas Aylmer Ruthin, the guardian of my daughter, Maud.
My father's will made my uncle Silas my guardian until I was 21, when he would render my inheritance to me.
And to whom will the property belong in the case my little cousin should die before she comes of age?
Why, her uncle, Mr. Silas Ruthin.
I had never met my Uncle Silas. My father would not talk of him.
It has to be acknowledged, your Uncle Silas was suspected of committing a murder.
And now my cousin Monica was the only person who could tell me the story.
We present George Cole as Silas Ruthin and Teresa Gallagher as his niece Maud in Uncle Silas by Sheridan Le Fanu.
Cousin Monica?
Yes, Maud?
You are dejected.
Yes, Maud.
Is it because of the will? I wish you to tell me more about Uncle Silas.
It is 20 years now since I saw him. I did not choose to visit his house.
Was that before the dreadful occurrence at Bartram Howe?
Yes, dear, before. He was not a reformed rake then, only a vicious one.
Has my aunt been long dead?
12 or 15 years, more indeed. She died before your poor mamma.
Did you like her?
My dear, she was a coarse, vulgar woman. And then came that odious business about wretched Mr. Chark. You know, he committed suicide at Bartram.
And Uncle Silas was...
And Uncle Silas was suspected by some people of having murdered him.
But you did not suspect him.
No, of course I did not.
Who was Mr. Chark?
Mr. Chark was, my dear, a gentleman of the turf. He was at Matlock Races, and your uncle invited him to Bartram Howe.
But why?
Your uncle's finances had collapsed. He was as hungry as a hawk.
They said he swooped upon this rich London gamester, intending to win his money. Mr. Chalk made heavy wages with him in the races, and they played very deep besides at Bartram. He and Silas would sit up at night at cards.
And why did Mr. Chalk kill himself?
Well, I will tell you first what all are agreed about. The morning after the races, Mr. Chalk's servant was at his master's door.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, sir. Mr. Chalk. Mr. Chalk. Mr. Chalk.
Is there anything untoward?
Oh, Mr. Ruffin, sir. It's Mr. Chalk. I can't raise a reply.
Then do not stand on ceremony. Go in.
Oh, it's locked.
Lawrence. Lawrence, let us in. It's Silas. Lawrence, open the door. We shall have to break it down.
They did so.
Lord Silas! Mr. Chalk!
He's dead, man. He's cut his throat.
But the...
A pond of blood. Do not touch anything. All must be as we found it. I am a justice of the peace. Together we will compile a record of what has been found.
Could anything be more straightforward, more right and wise?
Oh, nothing, of course.
Send for the coroner. Dr. Slaithwaite.
Mr. Ruthin, a dreadful business.
The poor man took his own life, I think.
Oh, what leads you to that conclusion?
Observe. We broke open the door, did we not?
Yes, sir.
And where was the key?
It's in the lock, on the inside.
He had locked himself in.
I begin to see your direction. The window?
You will note it is screwed shut, also from the inside. Wyatt had instructions to do that before Mr. Chalk retired. You can ask Wyatt. You can ask her.
And the courtyard, outside the window?
It is in the middle of the house and completely enclosed by it.
The entry is choked with weeds.
Yes. Yes, it has not been used these 10 years.
And, Mr. Ruthin, the chimney?
You.
Sir?
The chimney.
Oh, sir.
What do you see?
There's an iron bar across it at the top of the flue.
Could you get past it?
No, sir.
And I will have the wainscoting taken off to prove there is no other means of ingress.
Why, Mr. Ruthin, are you so eager to establish the suicide?
The rumour, Dr. Slaithwaite, the false report.
I understand you, sir.
Dr. Slaithwaite?
Well?
Last night, sir.
What of it?
Pray, go on.
Last night, sir, I accompanied my master to this room after he had finished at cards with Mr. Ruffin. He went in, sir, and then dismissed me.
So?
Well, he was happy, sir. He was tipsy, but he was happy. He said he had won a large amount off you, sir, on the course and at table.
I was not aware gentlemen discussed their winnings with their servants. At any rate, I think you'll find he was mistaken.
Well, that may be, sir, but he was happy. As he closed the door, he was singing. Lily Bolero.
His disposition would change. You must have observed it.
Yes, sir.
There is his razor, in his blood, by his right hand.
Yet the fingers on his left hand are cut to the bone.
This is immaterial. Mr. Chalk hermetically sealed himself into his own room and cut his own throat with his own razor.
As you say, it would appear so.
So the answer to the calumny was simply that the crime was impossible.
There were other doubts. Mr. Chalk, it was discovered, had little or no money with him. Silas averred he had been losing very heavily. Indeed, the losses and troubles Mr. Chalk had in London were adduced as motives for his act. This did not mollify suspicion, and your uncle was completely ostracized.
How unjust! And he has become religious.
He owes money, he is poor, he is isolated. It is the only occupation remaining for him.
But what do you think of him?
Silas Ruthin is himself alone. I can't define him.
The next day, Dr. Brierly asked to see me in the study. He had been a close friend of my father's and was chief executor of the will.
You know, miss, your uncle, Mr. Silas Ruthin, was talked about unpleasantly once.
You mean concerning the death of Mr. Chalk at Bartram House?
We assume, of course, unjustly. But there are many who think quite differently.
And probably, Dr. Brierly,
It was for that very reason my dear papa made him my guardian. He wished to show his high opinion of my uncle's fitness for such a trust.
There can be no doubt of that, miss. It was to purge him of the scandal. But if you should happen to die, miss, during your minority, we are all mortal and there are 3 years and some months to go. How would it be then, don't you see?
Well, he is my near relative.
The whole of the property will go to him, and he has custody of your person in the meantime. You are to live in his house under his care and authority. Don't you see, miss, it is not a fit position to put your uncle in. If you made up your mind you would rather be placed under the care of, say, your cousin, Lady Knollys, I will endeavour all I can to effect it.
But that could not be done without his consent, could it?
No, but I don't despair of getting that, on terms, of course.
I don't quite understand.
I mean, for instance, if he were to keep the allowance for your maintenance.
Surely it is not the allowance that is my uncle's object, but rather the moral value of the position.
We might at any event try him. I must be in London the day after tomorrow. Bartram Howe is 60 miles from here, and only 20 of that I find by rail. But if you say try, I'll see him tomorrow morning.
Very well. Yes, Dr. Briley.
You have resolved wisely and well.
2 days later, Cousin Monica and I received Dr. Briley's dispatch from his campaign.
I this day saw Mr. Silas Ruthin at Bartram Howe, and he peremptorily refuses on any terms to vacate the guardianship or to consent to Miss Ruthin residing anywhere but under his own immediate care. He bases his refusal twofold. First, upon a conscientious duty, declaring that he has no right through fear of personal contingencies to abdicate an office imposed in so solemn a way, and so naturally devolving on him as only brother of the deceased. Second, the effect such a withdrawal at the instance of the chief executor would have upon his own character, amounting to a public self-condemnation. As Mr. Ruthin refused to discuss these positions with me, I could make no way whatsoever with him. Therefore, after a short time, I took my leave. He mentioned that preparations for his niece's reception are being completed, and that he will send for her in a few days.
There. It is settled.
We were foolish to raise our hopes.
You won't forsake me, Cousin Monica?
No, darling, never. Don't part with Mary Quince. They'll want you to, but don't.
Well, I have no intention.
They'll say she's not fit for a lady's maid, as she certainly is not. But she is attached, trustworthy, and honest. And these are qualities valuable everywhere, especially in a solitude.
Yes. Yes, I know her qualities are...
Can she write, in case you were ill? Can she take a message exactly?
But you'll come and see me, won't you, as often as you can?
Yes, dear. That is, if Silas allows me.
Why should he not allow you?
I'm sure he will. Perhaps he will allow you to come to me now and then for a short visit. I am only 7 miles away from Bartram Howe, a little more than half an hour's drive. You know, I haven't been to Bartram for over 20 years.
Why, now is your opportunity to renew you.
I have never understood Silas. I fancy he forgives no sins, whether of omission or commission. Yes, I shall. I will call at Bartram.
The day of my departure arrived. I took my leave of Mrs. Rusk, a housekeeper for as long as I could remember.
God bless you, Miss Maud, darling. You must not fret, mind. The time won't be long going over. No time at all. And you'll be bringing back a fine young gentleman. Well, who knows, as great as the Duke of Wellington for your husband.
Oh, Mrs. Rusk.
I'll take best care of everything. And the birds and the dogs till you come back. I'll come and see you and Mary, if you'll allow, in Derbyshire.
Mrs. Rusk. And Mary Quince and I got into the carriage and we were off. And the last I heard of Noel was the dogs.
Miss Maud.
Yes, Mary?
Are you crying?
Yes, Mary. A little.
I am minded to join you, save that the carriage would be damp.
So, Mary.
So, Miss Maud.
What kind of life do you think we shall lead at Bartram Howe?
I have no notion.
Neither have I. But I am sure it will be secluded.
Bartram Howe is in Derbyshire.
That is so, Mary.
I've never been out of Warwickshire.
Eight hours later, we arrived at Bartram. It was dark.
Whoa there!
Well, Mary?
Is she here? Is she here?
Miss Maud.
Now are we in Derbyshire?
Yes or no? Is my cousin in the court?
She is!
Then why don't you let her out, you stupid? You're very welcome to Bartram. I said you're very welcome to Bartram.
Thank you.
I'm your cousin Millie. I'd let you out myself, only I daren't go down the steps. The governor said I mustn't.
I'll hand you down, miss.
Thank you.
I'll take the boxes into the house.
Yeah, miss.
Thank you. She's coming, she's coming.
Mary.
Here, miss.
Let us go into the house.
Oh, she's finally here. Maud.
Millie.
Give your cousin a hearty buss. She needs a kiss.
Oh, cousin.
You'll want to take off your cape, then talk to the governor.
Who's the governor?
Father, of course. He's a bit frail. He took a pain on Friday. Neuralgia, he calls it, but if it's anyone else, it's rheumatism. So he's sitting in his own room.
Why won't he let you... No, it's not right to ask.
Ask what you like, cousin. I can only say nay.
Why won't he let you down the steps? Aren't you allowed out of the house?
Oh, that's just his fancy for today. Tomorrow will be different. Who's the old one?
This is my maid, Mary Quince.
Oh, the maid! And a precious old one at that!
I hope you don't think
Oh, you're welcome, Quince, you're welcome. It's only a bit of chaff.
Oh, thank you. Miss...
Millie! Millie, just plain Millie. Now, I'll take you to the governor. Mind how you make a noise.
What do you mean?
The governor's sharp as a weasel. Nothing vexes him like that.
Is he a martinet?
Now, I don't know what you mean.
Pray enter.
It's my cousin Maud.
I had scarcely anticipated otherwise. Welcome, my dear niece.
Thank you, my dear uncle.
You have the look of your father upon you.
I hope that is a cause for consolation rather than concern.
How felicitously put. Pray sit down. That includes you, Millicent.
Yes.
I need not introduce my daughter. She saved me that mortification.
Well, on the contrary, it's been a pleasure.
You'll find her, I believe, good-natured and affectionate. Au rest, I fear a very rustic Miranda, more fitted for the society of a Caliban than of a sick old Prospero. Is that not so, Millicent?
I don't know who they be, neither one nor t'other.
You see, my dear Maud, what a Shakespearean you have for a cousin. You see her, poor thing, a result of all the combined disadvantages. She wants refined education, refined companionship, and, I fear, naturally, refined tastes.
I hope I can make some modest contribution to the second.
Meantime, she warbles her native wood notes wild.
You're too clever for
me. A sojourn at a good French conventual school will do wonders, and that I hope to arrange by and by.
He's always threatening me with...
Millicent! Let us jest at our misfortune and love one another, I hope, cordially. Yes, I hope cordially.
I am sure we shall. The next day I explored the woods around Bartram, with Millie as my companion.
Who's that girl ahead?
That's Zamiel's daughter.
And who is Zamiel?
He's the miller. See, yonder it is. Mill not going today, beauty?
No, Millie, it's not.
Hey, what's gone with the stile? It's torn away from its paling.
Why, so it be.
Who's been and done all that?
Not you or me, lass.
Old Zamiel, your father, did it.
Happen it was.
And the gate locked.
That's it, the gate locked.
And where's Zamiel?
Up to the side somewhere. How should I know where he is?
Who's got the key?
Here it be, lass.
How dare you stay us? Undo it, hussy, this minute. Open the gate this instant.
Well, I won't.
I could get over the paling as soon as look at you, but I won't. Open the gate, I say, or I'll make you.
Do leave her alone, dear. She has been ordered, maybe, not to open it. Is it not so, my good girl?
Well, you are not the biggest fool of the two.
And who ordered you?
Father.
Well, that's something to lay at, that is. Our servant shutting us out of our own grounds.
He's no servant of yours.
Come, lass, what do you mean?
He's old Silas's miller. And what's that to you?
Oh, so I am. And what's that to you, eh?
Open the gate.
So you'd go where you like, would you? and do no but what pleases you.
I am Miss Maud Ruthen of Knoll, and Mr. Silas Ruthen, your master, is my uncle.
Oh, you she as comes overnight, eh? But Maud or no Maud, I wouldn't let the Duke himself set foot outside the paling without Silas had let him. And you may tell Silas, them's the words of Samuel Oakes, and I'll stick to them. And what's more, I'll tell him myself I will.
I'll complain of you to my uncle.
Do so. Happen you find yourself in the wrong box. You can't say I set the dogs on you, nor call you so much as a wrong name, not even aimed a stone at you, can you? Well then, where's the complaint then?
Be good enough to leave me.
Well, I'll make no objections. Mind, I'm taking you a word, you're more Druthin. Maybe you are, maybe you're not. I'm not aware of it, but I take your word. Good afternoon, Miss Ruthin and Miss Ruthin. Meg?
Yeah!
Very well, then.
Oh, Miss Maud.
I don't know who you are.
I'm Wyatt, the housekeeper.
I wish to see my uncle. Is he within?
He is and he is not.
I don't understand you.
Come in and see for yourself.
He's ill. He's dying.
Oh, to noise. Oh, begging your pardon, miss, but he's just sitting in his chair by his fire in a world of his own.
Shouldn't we fetch a doctor?
Shh, don't make no noise, miss, till he talks. You'll come to for a bit soon.
Is he off?
Shh.
Ah, the girl. Austin's child. Oh, dear, I'm hardly able. I'll speak tomorrow. Next day. This is trying. Neuralgia or something. Torture. Tell her.
Come away, miss. You'll not be fit to talk to you now a day, all day, maybe. Come away.
He looks as if he's dying. Should we send for a doctor?
Oh, bless you. Doctor knows all about it.
It can't be safe to leave him to chance or nature to get through these terrible attacks.
There's no fear of him. He's no fit, and he's none the worse for it. He's just a bit silly now and again. It's been the same a dozen year, and the doctor knows all about it.
The miller's behaviour had disturbed me, so I resolved to speak to his daughter, the creature called Beauty.
Good morning.
Good morning, miss.
This is the way to the mill.
That's right, miss.
Do you work at Bartram?
I work at Stables, miss.
And what is your name?
Tom Bryce, miss.
Tom Bryce. Haven't I seen you before?
Not that I know of.
Are you a good whip? Do you drive well?
I drive a plough with most lads hereabouts.
Have you ever been to Knoll?
No.
Here, Tom, is half a crown.
Oh, thank you, miss. That'd be very good.
Now, Tom, you'll tell me, have you ever been to Knoll?
I might have been, but I don't mind no such place, no.
Now, Tom, recollect yourself and tell me the truth, and I'll be a friend to you. Did you drive a coach with several gentlemen which came to the grounds of Knoll when the party had their lunches on the grass and there was a quarrel with the gamekeepers? Try, Tom, to recollect. You should, upon my honour, have no trouble about it.
I never drove a coach in my days, miss. And I've never been out of Derbyshire but thrice to Warwick Fair with horses by rail and twice to York.
You're certain, Tom?
Certain. Sure. Begging your pardon, miss, but why did the gentleman go on a coach? Why didn't they ride?
I continued to the windmill. This day, it was working.
I'll teach you!
No, Dad, no! No!
No! You're not seeing!
I don't see me!
If I see
Price,
are you?
Don't!
I'll
no,
beat him out
no.
If you like
a... Oh, no, Father, no! No!
I was appalled.
No, 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 no.
I turned and ran. I won't let him do it. I'll stop him.
You see, my dear child, they are rough persons. Their ideas are not ours.
But he struck her violently on the head, Uncle, and she was bleeding very fast.
Their young people must be chastised, and in a way we would look upon in a serious light.
I really think if he goes on treating her with so much cruelty, he may injure her very seriously.
I found it a bad plan interfering in strictly domestic undertakings and should rather not.
Or he may perhaps kill her.
Why, you romantic little child. People in that rank of life think absolutely nothing of a broken head.
But is it not brutality?
To be sure it is brutality. But then you must remember they are brutal, and it suits them.
I will bid you good night, sir.
There is one small thing more.
Yes, sir.
You have as your companion a rather elderly lady.
Yes, Mary Quince, my maid.
Mary Quince, your maid. Are you very attached to her?
Why do you ask, sir?
She's not really suited to attend to someone like yourself. Crabbed age and youth cannot live together. I'm sure I could supply you with someone more suitable.
I am very attached to Mary Quince, and I think she is devoted to me.
Why, then, I shall pursue the matter no further.
At the end of May, Dr. Brierly came to see my uncle on business. Naturally, I was not party to it, but afterwards...
Glad to find you alone for a minute. Very glad. I want to know, are you really quite comfortable here?
Quite.
You've only your cousin's company.
Yes, but Millie and I are very happy together.
Well, that's very nice, but I think there are no teachers of any kind, are there?
No. My uncle thinks it better I should lay in a store of health.
I know. And the carriage and horses you promised have not come? How soon are they expected?
I really can't say, and I assure you I don't much care. I think running about great fun.
You walk to church?
Yes. Uncle Silas's carriage wants a new wheel, he tells me.
Aye, but a young lady of your rank, it is not usual she should be without the use of a carriage. Have you horses to ride?
No.
Your uncle, you know, has a very liberal allowance for your maintenance and education.
Are you suggesting he is misappropriating it?
I'm observing he has supplied it, but does not appear to be disbursing it. Is he kind to you?
He is affectionate, in his fashion.
Well, why doesn't he keep company with you? Does he ever dine with you, or drink tea, or talk to you?
He is a miserable invalid. His hours and regimen are peculiar. He is, I believe, often insensible for a long time, when his mind is in a strange, feeble state.
I dare say, worn out in his young days. And I saw that preparation of opium in his bottle. He takes too much.
And what do you think his complaint is?
One way or another, he's been all his days working on his nerves and his brain. These men of pleasure who have no other pursuit use themselves up mostly and pay a smart price for their sins. Have you been thinking at all about that other matter? I mean about getting your uncle to forgo his guardianship.
I have not thought of it at all.
I would not mind his first refusal. You could make it worth his while unless he... That is, unless he's very unreasonable indeed.
I am very fond of my cousin Millie.
How long have you been here exactly?
Almost 3 months.
Have you seen your other cousin yet, the young gentleman?
No.
Aren't you very lonely?
I was, as you know, prepared for it.
You'd be pleasanter somewhere else, with Lady Knollys, for instance, eh?
Well, there certainly.
This is not a fit place for you.
The following week, Cousin Monica fulfilled her promise.
My dearest Maud.
Oh, Monica.
Now let me look at you. You are well?
Oh, even better for seeing you.
Oh, you have no idea what self-denial I have exercised to bring this visit about. I have actually written 5 letters to Silas, and I don't think I said a single impertinent thing in one of them.
Millie, dear, this is your cousin, Lady Knollys.
And so you are Millicent. Well, dear, I am very glad to see you, and we must be very good friends, you funny creature. I'm allowed to be the most saucy old woman in Derbyshire, and nobody is ever affronted with me, so I say the most shocking things constantly.
I'm a bit that way myself, and I think...
You think? Oh, now take my advice, and never wait to think, my dear. Talk first and think afterwards. That is my way, though indeed I can't say I ever think at all. And now, do you think, girls, you could be ready to come away with me, if Silas gives leave, in an hour or two? I should so like you both to visit Elverston.
Oh, how delightful. Oh, yes, darling, for my part, I should be ready in 5 minutes. What do you say, Millie? Millie?
What does she say?
There's a deal of my slops in the wash.
In the name of wonder, what does my cousin mean?
My best petticoat is away at the laundress.
Mr. Rutherford will see you now.
Come, girls!
You see a change, Monica.
I do see a change, Silas. And no doubt so do you in me. A great change.
The change is not as great as time would lead me to expect.
It has been a long time, Silas, but that, you know, is not my fault.
Not your fault, my dear. Your instinct. We're all instinctive creatures. The great people ostracized me, and the small ones followed.
Now, Silas, I am not here to quarrel. If we quarrel now, mind, we can never make it up. We are too old.
My personal wrongs I can quite forgive, and I do, heaven knows, from my heart. Will you shake hands?
With all my heart.
Here, I do strike a truce, and do forget and forgive everything. See, girls, Lady Knollys and I, cousins long estranged, forget and forgive the past, and join hands over its buried injuries. My dear niece, your presence at Bartram has wrought this reconciliation.
Well, I am pleased to have been the occasion.
I wish so much, dear Monica, that I could ask you to stay tonight. But absolutely I have not a bed to offer, and even if I had, I fear my suit would hardly prevail.
Silas.
Monica.
I have a request.
Pray adumbrate it.
I should like to invite Maud and Millicent to stay with me at Elverston for a few days.
Now, when would you like them to come?
They could go with me today, when I return.
What, all my pretty chicks gone? There is a difficulty. I shall not bore you by going into it, but suffice it to say it is substantial. A difficulty in their going with you today. However, on a future day, soon, very soon, I shall be most happy to send them.
Thank you, Silas.
It will be a pleasure.
Silas, I shall hold you to it. Millie, my dear, will you put on your hat and you and Maud show me the grounds about the house? May they, Silas? I should like to renew my acquaintance.
You'll see them sadly neglected, Monnie. A poor man's pleasure grounds must rely on nature and trust to her for effects.
Now, girls, what do you say? Will he let you come? Yes or no?
I don't know. You never do with the governor.
Is that what you call him?
I always have.
You are to come with me. You shall. I'll manage it.
Oh, look at the herons.
Oh, he ought to let you see a little more of the world than appears among the glens and the bushes.
There's an old grey trout by the bridge. I'll see if he's there.
Yes, you do that.
I won't be long.
You have been talking to Dr. Brierly.
I know of his conversation with you.
Do you intend to go along?
I implore you, Maud, to think of this seriously. When you come to me, you shall do so with the intention of remaining at Elverston.
Cousin Monica, is this fair? You and Dr. Brierly both talk in the same awful way to me, yet you won't, either of you, say exactly what you mean.
I don't like this place, and I don't like Silas. I've tried, you've seen me, but I can't, and I think I never shall. You must know, my dear Maud, what a prize you are. You are an immense trust.
One evening in mid-June, Uncle Silas summoned me to his study.
You'll excuse my not rising, dear Maud. I'm so miserably ill this evening.
I am sorry your health reduces you to this state.
Yes, I am to be pitied. I sent for you to make you acquainted with your cousin, my son. Where are you, Dudley?
Here, Father.
Come, sir, we must not be modest. Here's your cousin Maud. What do you say?
How are you, miss?
You are...
Miss? Come, come. Miss us no missus. She is Maud and you Dudley. She'll not refuse to shake your hand, will you, dear Maud? Come, young gentleman, speak for yourself.
How are you, Maud? You're welcome to Bartram Hall, miss.
Kiss your cousin, sir. Where's your gallantry? On my honour, I disown you.
No, no. Let us shake hands.
There.
Well, well, that will do, I suppose. In my time, first cousins did not meet like strangers. But perhaps we were wrong. We are learning modesty from the Americans, and old English ways are too gross for us.
I have seen him before. That is...
Why, this is news. You never told me. When have you met, eh, Dudley?
Never saw him a day, so far as I'm aware of.
No? Well, then, Maud, would you enlighten us?
I did see that young gentleman before.
Meaning me, ma'am?
Yes, certainly you. I did, Uncle.
And where was it, my dear?
I met him, Uncle. Your son... Young gentleman, I saw him, I should say, at Church Scarsdale, and afterwards with some other persons in the grounds at Knoll.
There was an altercation with the gamekeepers.
Well, Dudley, what do you say to that?
I was never at them places, so help me. I don't know where they are, and I've never set eyes on the young lady before.
You look so uncomfortable, Maud, at the idea of having seen him before. There was plainly something disagreeable. Dudley, you were not at these places?
I wish I may be smitten.
There, that will do. Your honour and word as a gentleman, and that you are, although an impecunious one, will quite satisfy your cousin Maud. Am I right, dear?
I swear by Almighty God that I've never
That's
seen...
enough. Now shake hands again, if you won't kiss like cousins.
Thank you, miss.
You'll want some supper, Dudley, so Maud and I will excuse you going. Good night, dear boy.
Good night, Father. Good night, cousin Maud.
That's as fine a young fellow, I think, as any English father can boast for his son. True, brave, and kind, and quite an Apollo. I've seen something of the world in my day, and I can say without a misgiving of partiality that Dudley is the material of a perfect English gentleman. I'm not blind, of course. The training must be supplied. A year or two of good models, active self-criticism, and good society. I simply say that the material is there. You have nothing to say?
I'm glad he has your approbation.
About these places, church, whatever it is.
Church Scarsdale.
And the grounds at Knoll. I never knew him to utter an untruth. He was not there.
After a few days, my cousin insisted we became better acquainted.
Afternoon.
Will you have something, Dudley?
Oh, no, lass, but I'll look at you both and maybe drink a drop for company. Curate's up with Governor. I wanted a word with him, but I suppose I'll hardly get in this hour or more, praying and disputing and Bible-chopping as usual. Mind, won't hold much longer. Now that Uncle Austin's dead, there's nowt to be made of praying.
Oh, for shame, you sinner! Dudley wasn't in a church these 5 years, and then only to meet a young lady.
I wonder, Millie, at your laughing. How can you laugh?
You'd have me cry, would you?
I certainly would not have you laugh.
Oh, I know I wish someone would cry for me, and I know who. No disrespect about your father.
No?
These parsons be awful slow coaches. I should be 3 miles away or more by this time, and why can't folks stick to a Sunday? Millie, lass... Will you see if the governor be finished with curate? I'm losing a whole day.
Oh, you're a woundy, ugly customer in a wax.
I say, it is a hard case. A lad of spirit should be kept so tight.
Perhaps my uncle thinks you should earn some for yourself.
Well, I'd like to know how a fellow's to earn money nowadays. I mean, you wouldn't have a gentleman keep a shop, I fancy. But I'll have a fistful soon. Those executors, you know, owes me a great deal of money. Very honest chaps, of course, but they're cursed slow about paying.
Are you referring to...
And I tell you, Maud, when I get the tin, I know who I'll buy a fairing for. I do, lass. And there's something, lass, I must have in return. Honour thy father, you know. I mean, you'd not have me disobey the governor.
I don't understand you.
Oh, I'd back those eyes against the country, I would.
Your tone, sir, is becoming...
You're awful pretty, you are, Maud. I don't know what came over me the other night when the governor told me to bush you. But you won't deny me now. I'll have a kiss, lass, in spite of they blushes.
I will not put up with it.
If she isn't going to fight me, now come on, Maud. You would not be so ill-natured, surely. I mean, it's only our duty. The governor bid us to...
Don't! Don't, sir! Stand back or I'll call the servants. Millie! Millie! Millie!
Oh, that's how it is. That's how it is with all the cattle. You never know your own mind. You make such a row, a bit of play.
Millie!
Stop it, will you? There's no one harming you. Morning, Maud.
Mr. Ruthin?
Oh, Maud. Don't be distant with your cousin.
Sir?
Is it not hard lines? Now, Maud, is it not hard lines?
Is what hard lines?
There's the governor, says he hasn't a bob. How does an old fellow in his bedroom muddle away money at that rate? I don't suppose he thinks I can get along without tin. Is it not hard lines?
I hardly think I am the right person to apply to for...
No, it's not that. I never known a real beauty. First chop, I mean, that wasn't kind along of it. I'm a fellow as can't get along without sympathy. And that's why I said it.
Isn't it hard lines? Now say it's hard lines, ain't it, Maud?
I suppose it is very disagreeable.
No, that's just it. I knew you'd say it, Maud. You're a kind lass, you are. It's in your pretty face. I like you awful well, I do. There's not a handsomer lass in Liverpool or London itself. No. No way.
Keep your distance, sir.
No offence, lass. No harm. Maud, you must not be so shy. We're cousins, you know. I wouldn't hurt you, Maud. No more than I'd knock my own head off, I wouldn't.
I'm glad to hear it.
I shall be going away for a week, if I can get the tin. Don't think badly of me.
He got the tin.
I sent for you, dear, because I desire to have no secrets.
2 days after Dudley's departure...
And wish you thoroughly to know all that concerns your interests while subject to my guardianship.
Events now came pell-mell.
I am happy to think, my beloved niece, that you requite my candour. Oh, here is the gentleman. Sit down, dear Maud.
Mr. Ruthin.
Forgive me, I cannot rise.
You seem better than when I last saw you.
However, I cannot rise.
How do you do, miss?
Very well, thank you, Dr. Briley.
I'm glad to find one person in health. I think I may as well take a chair, sir.
If you wish.
Thank you. You understand the nature of the business, sir? Do you wish Miss Ruthin to remain?
I sent for her, sir.
Very well.
This gentleman, my dear Maud, thinks it proper to insinuate that I am robbing you. It surprises me a little, and no doubt you. I've nothing to conceal and wish you to be present while he favours me more particularly with his views. I am right, I think, in describing it as robbery, sir?
Why, it would be, certainly, taking that which does not belong to you and converting it to your own use. But at the worst, it would more resemble thieving, I think, than robbery.
Your note says appropriation, I think, sir.
Yes. The receipt of money is not then disbursed to their proper use, as I am informed.
Detectives or private spies of your own? No doubt bribed with my poor brother's money.
Uncle.
Niece, a very high-minded procedure.
Nothing of the kind, sir.
Really?
I mean, sir, there has been no undue canvas for evidence. The question is simply one of right. It is our duty to see this inexperienced young lady is not defrauded.
By her uncle?
By anyone.
Of course you come armed with an opinion.
The case is before Mr. Sergeant Grinders. He has not yet returned it.
Then you have no opinion.
My solicitor is quite clear upon it. And it seems to me there can be no question raised but for form's sake.
Yes, for form's sake. And in the meantime, upon a nice question of law, the surmises of a thick-headed attorney and an ingenious divine are sufficient warrant for telling my niece and ward, in my presence, that I am defrauding her.
I don't know whether I use that expression, sir, but I am speaking merely in a technical sense.
I am a technical defrauder, I see, and your manner conveys the rest. I thank my God, sir, that I am a very different man from what I once was. I should certainly have knocked you down for a great deal less.
But seriously, sir, what do you propose?
I propose to defend my rights, sir. I am not without an opinion, though you are.
You seem to think, sir, that I have a pleasure in annoying you. You're quite wrong. But don't you see, sir, as chief executor, the position I'm placed in?
I neither deny nor admit anything.
So?
So, sir, if you please, sir, you will never more present yourself under any pretext whatsoever, either in this house or the grounds of Bartram Howe, during my lifetime.
Uncle,
quiet, Maud. This interview is terminated.
Goodbye, sir. Do you think, miss, that you could afford me a word in the hall?
Not a word, sir.
I should...
Sit where you are, Maud. If you have anything to say to my ward, sir, you will please to say it in here.
I was going to say... that if you think of any way I can be of the least service, miss, I am ready to act. Any way. That's all, miss.
Won't you shake hands with me, Dr. Briley, before you go?
Of course. Goodbye, miss.
What am I to do? What am I to do?
Oh, please don't distress yourself, Miss
Maud. He has forbidden me to see him.
I don't see what else he could do.
Cut me off from sound financial sense.
You never really did care for Dr. Briley.
I begin to get some inkling of what my uncle is about.
I think he's strange, but not vicious.
I can always write to Dr. Briley.
Do you have an address?
Oh, I can find one.
Your uncle would stop the letter from going out.
Yet you say he is not vicious.
Well, it is his duty. He sees every letter that goes out of the house.
He opens them?
No, but they pass through his hands.
I shall have to go down to the village.
You will be seen.
Then you will have to go down to the village.
They would see if I posted anything.
Then we shall have to find someone else.
I don't see why you're so worried.
There is Cousin Monica. You are right, Mary. I am over-agitated. I cannot abide scenes. Why haven't Millie and I been to Elverston yet?
Back again, like a bad ape, you see.
I see.
How have you been ever since, lass? Right, well, I warrant by your looks. Oh, I'm jolly glad to see you, I am.
I think I must ask you to let go my hand.
Anything to pleasure you, Maud.
Thank you.
I've been to Wolverhampton, lass. A jolly row there. And run over to Leamington. Almost broke my neck, Faith, with a borrowed horse after the dogs. You would not care, Maud, if I broke my neck, would you? Well, happened just a little. Only a bit over a week since I left here, by George, and to me it's half the almanac. Can you guess the reason, Maud?
Have you seen your sister or your father since your return?
They'll keep, Maud. It's you I want to see. I tell you, lass, I'm always thinking of you.
I think you ought to go and see your father. You've been away. I don't think it's respectful.
If you bid me go, I'd almost go, but I could not quite. There's nothing on earth I would not do for you, Maud, except leaving you.
And that is the only thing on earth I would ask you to do.
Blessed if you aren't blushing, Maud.
It's just too bad.
Oh, you're angry with me now, just because you think I got into trouble at Wolverhampton. You are. You are.
I don't understand you, sir. And I beg that you'll leave me.
And that's the one thing I can't do. I'm just a child in your hands, I am, you know. Look at me here. Just a child, I say, in your hands.
Why can't you leave me alone, sir?
Maud, how can you be so ill-natured when you see me like this? How can you?
I wish Millie would come.
Well, I'll tell you how it is, Maud. I may as well have it out. I like you better than any lass I ever saw, a deal. You're nice by chalks. There's none like you. There isn't. And I wish you'd have me. Oh, I haven't much tin. Father's run through a deal. He's pretty well up a tree, you know. But though I ain't as rich as some folk, I'm a better man. If you'd take a tidy lad that likes you awful and would die for your sake, why, here he is.
What can you mean, sir?
I mean, Maud, if you'll marry me, you'll never have cause to regret it.
Actually, a proposal.
Actually, a proposal.
Well, I...
Oh, good lass, you would not deny me.
What has there ever been, sir, in my conduct, words or looks, to warrant this unparalleled audacity? But that you are as stupid as you are impertinent, brutal and ugly. You must long ago, sir, have seen how I dislike you. How dare you, sir?
Well, look here, lass, I
don't think... Don't presume to obstruct me. I'm going to my uncle. Your son, sir, has insulted me.
Insulted you? You surprise me. How? How has Dudley insulted you, my dear child? I did not know he was here. Come, you're excited. Sit down.
Now,
take time and tell me all about it.
It is an insult. He knew very well. He must know how I dislike him, and he presumed to make a proposal of marriage to me.
Aha! And that is the amount of your complaint. He made you a formal proposal of marriage.
I hardly see it as anything to laugh.
No, my dear little Maud. My dear Maud, however just, you appear to me a little cruel. You are yourself to blame. You have a faithful friend whom I advise you consult. Your looking glass. The foolish fellow is young, quite ignorant of the world's ways. He is in love, and aimer c'est craindre, et craindre c'est souffrir. We must not be too hard on him.
I am surprised, Uncle, that you find...
But after all, is it quite such a folly? It really strikes me, dear Maud, that the subject may be worth a second thought.
But Uncle, you can't...
No, you won't refuse to hear me. I am, of course, assuming you are fancy-free. I am assuming also you don't care tuppence about Dudley, and that you view him with some aversion. There is nothing like beginning with a little aversion.
Uncle, I cannot believe you would be so cynical as to...
Believe me, I speak out of experience. There are one or two points you must bear in mind. One of the happiest privileges of your fortune is that you may, without imprudence, marry simply for love.
There are few men in England who could offer you an estate comparable to that you already possess, or in fact appreciably increase the splendour of your fortune.
I see you have thought about this.
As should you. If, therefore, Dudley were in all other respects eligible, I can't see his poverty would be an objection to weigh for one moment. My good fellow, I happen to be talking about my son and should rather not be overheard.
Oh, well, very good, then.
Dudley has fine qualities. The most affectionate son, in his rough way, that ever father was blessed with. Indomitable courage and a high sense of honour. And lastly, he has the Ruthin blood. The purest blood, I maintain, in England. I am also anxious my boy should not be dismissed from his home. You see, my dear, he must be if you persevere in rejecting his suit.
I have no wish
I cannot do but otherwise. It would not be proper. I beg you, reserve your decision to this day week, when I will, with much pleasure, hear what you may have to say on the subject. But till then, observe me not a word.
Beauty sick, Maud.
What with?
Rheumatic fever.
Is it infectious?
The sawbone says no more than a broken leg.
Millie and I spent the week in nursing.
Your daughter is very ill, I hear.
Aye, she'll be tossing me handful, like her mother did.
When did the illness commence?
It was the day the mayor was shot. Saturday. I talked to it at workhouse, but they wouldn't give me notes.
The doctor costs nothing.
Aye, and does nothing. If she keeps on that way, I'll leave her flat and see how the workout's like that.
Well, maybe we can be of some use.
Maybe.
Millie?
Maud?
She is totally neglected. We know what we must do.
Little by little, our patient began to recover.
I think, Meg, you ought to thank Miss Millie.
I'll not thank her.
I don't mind if she don't...
Very well, very well.
It's not her I should be thanking. It's you.
Maud?
Uncle?
A chair?
Thank you, Uncle. I prefer standing.
I too shall stand. You saw the luggage corded and addressed as it stands ready for removal in the hall?
Mr. Dudley A. Ruthin, Paris, via Dover.
I am old, agitated, on the eve of a decision on which much depends. Pray relieve my suspense. Is my son to leave Bartram today in sorrow or to remain in joy?
Uncle, I have thought long and hard, and I...
No, I crave one moment before you pronounce your doom. I have one final thing to say. I'm very miserable, very nearly desperate. What remains for me? What remains? Fortune has done her worst, thrown me in the dust, her wheels rolled over me, and the servile world who follows her chariot like a mob has stamped upon the mangled wretch. But this old hectic... This old epileptic, this old spectre of wrongs, calamities and follies, has still one hope. My manly, though untutored son. The last male scion of the Ruthins. He loves you, as none but the very young can love, but that once only in a life. A Ruthin. The best blood in England. The last man of the race. Maud, have I lost him? His fate, my fate, I may say Millie's fate, we all await your sentence. If I lose him, then I lose all. And you will see me in my coffin before many months. I stand before you in the attitude of a supplicant. Shall I kneel?
Oh, Uncle, Uncle!
You see my suspense. You see my miserable and frightful suspense. You are kind, Maud. You love your father's memory and are the living trust he placed in his brother, me. You would not betray that trust. You would not say no and place a pistol at my head.
Oh, I must say no. Oh, spare me, Uncle, for heaven's sake. Don't question me. I could not do what you ask.
I yield, Maud. I yield, my dear.
Oh, Uncle, how can I ever...
I will not press you. I will not question you. You shall have time, your own time to think. I will accept no answer now.
But
no, Maud, none.
He's trying to wear me down.
How is he doing that?
By not accepting a no. By not accepting a no.
Mr. Dudley is his son.
He's hoping to make me relent. But I won't, Mary. I won't.
No, Miss Maud.
What will he do when he realizes?
Realizes?
When he realizes I am not going to change my mind. I have been under my uncle's roof for almost 4 months, and I still don't know what manner of man he is.
When we could not walk in the grounds, Millie and I would explore the deserted upper floors of the house.
This is it.
We shouldn't be up here.
Why ever not?
Nobody ever comes to this part of the house. Wyatt says it's haunted.
Since when have you taken any notice of Wyatt? Anyway, we can't go out. Yes, this must be it.
What's riding you?
This must be the room in which Mr. Chark died.
Who's Mr. Chark?
Yes, look there, the inner courtyard.
Who's Mr. Chark?
And all the wainscotings torn off.
Who's Mr. Chark?
Nobody's told you. He was found dead here one morning with his throat cut end to end.
Oh, don't, Maud, you're
scary. And nobody could get in and nobody could get out.
Look at that stain on the floorboards.
I suppose it won't scrub out.
Maud?
La, 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 la.
Why are you singing that?
I don't know. Yes, I do know. La, 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 la.
Maud!
My dear Maud. My dear, dear child.
Madame de la Rochia.
You see, I have not forgotten you. And you, I think, have not forgotten me.
I had fainted.
In part two of Uncle Silas by Sheridan Le Fanu, Maud was played by Teresa Gallagher and Silas by George Cole. Lady Monica Knollys, Joan Sims, Madame de la Rougière, Dorothy Tutin, Mary Quince, Kathleen Byron, Mrs. Rusk, Tessa Worsley, Millie, Jane Wittenshaw, Dudley, Jonathan Keeble, Dr. Brierly, John Hartley, Zamiel, George A. Cooper, Beauty, Becky Hindley, Wyatt, Pauline Letts. Chark's servant, David Collings, Dr. Slaithwaite, John Evitts, Tom Bryce, Roger May, the coachman, Stephen Critchlow, Mr. Grimston, Geoffrey Whitehead. Uncle Silas was dramatized for radio by Alan Drury and directed by Enid Williams.
It was June in the year of 1865. I was 17. My father had died 3 months earlier, and I was the ward of my Uncle Silas living at his isolated house in Derbyshire. My uncle's reputation was stained.
You know, miss, your uncle, Mr. Silas Ruthin, was talked about unpleasantly once.
You mean concerning the death of Mr. Chark at Bartram Howe?
We assume, of course, unjustly. But there are many who think quite differently.
Dr. Brierly was the chief executor of my father's will and had my interests at heart. My uncle quarrelled with him and forbade him the house. My cousin Monica, Lady Knollys, also viewed the circumstances with trepidation.
You must know, my dear Maud, what a prize you are. You are an immense trust.
My concern grew when I was introduced to my cousin Dudley, Silas's son. He had been party to an attempt to abduct me before my father died, but my uncle was adamant.
He was not there.
And his son persistently wooed me. I complained to my uncle, but he supported his son's suit, saying such an alliance was the only salvation for him and his line.
What will he do when he realizes?
Realizes?
When he realizes I am not going to change my mind.
I was exploring the upper disused reaches of my uncle's house. With me was Millie, his daughter, and my boon companion.
Maud? Why are you singing that?
I don't know. Yes, I do know. La 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 la.
Maud!
My dear Maud. My dear, dear child.
Madame de la Roche?
You see, I have not forgotten you. And you, I think, have not forgotten me.
I had fainted.
We present George Cole as Silas Ruthin and Teresa Gallagher as his niece Maud in Uncle Silas by Sheridan Lefanu.
Maud? 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 Maud?
Oh, who is she? What is it?
She in the room?
She's gone to get you some water.
She was my governess at Knowles. She's evil. She hates me. I thought that...
She's coming.
Help me up. Thank you.
Ah, Maud. I see you are revived. Here is some water.
Where did you get it? No one lives on this floor.
Happily, I see you do not need it.
How long have you been at Bartram?
You do not introduce your dear, sweet madame to your friend. It is Miss Millicent, I think.
Yes.
I am enchanted to meet you.
I'm not enchanted to meet you.
Ah, Maud, Maud. Already you are spreading your lies, ma chère petite calomniatrice.
How long have you been at Bartram?
2 or 3 days.
And why are you here?
Your uncle, he sent for me. Why else?
My uncle sent for you?
From the convent school in France? Where else?
He's going to do it, Maud. He said he would. He's going to do it. He's going to send me away.
You shall go to see my uncle.
Let us do so.
I have certain things, madame, to tell him.
My dear Maud, you do not change.
Why am I disturbed, pray?
Miss Maud Rutin, she will explain.
Do you know this woman?
Please, Father, tell me it's not true.
Tell you that what is not true?
That you're sending me to France.
My dearest Millicent.
Yes?
It is entirely true.
Oh!
Now, Millicent, you will leave us. I shall explain things to you later.
No.
I must apologise for my daughter, madame. She's almost entirely lacking savoir-faire. Now, perhaps, Maud, you will explain to me what all this is about.
Do you know this woman?
I do not care for your tone.
Are you, sir, acquainted with madame?
I have spoken with her, that is all.
I am.
You're very blunt.
She was my governess at Knowle.
Is this so, madame?
It is so, monsieur.
Well, I wish you had mentioned it. Nevertheless, Maud, you must be delighted at the reunion.
I am not. Madame de la Rougière was dismissed from my father's service at an hour and a half's notice.
That is true, monsieur.
One night I observed her clandestinely going through my father's papers. She had obtained a false key to his desk. I informed my father, and after a painful interview, madame was sent packing back to France.
From whence she has been summoned.
I was sent packing, yes. There was a painful interview, yes. Miss Maud did make her allegations, certainly, but the allegations are completely false. I turn my face and spit upon them.
You hear her, my dear child? You hear her deny everything. What am I to think? You must excuse the bewilderment of my old head. It strikes me you must have made a mistake.
But, sir, I...
As you did over my son, Dudley.
I must ask you, Uncle, not to confuse two different...
It is you who are confused. Here is a conflict, my dear. In my mind, a perception of mistake. I confess I should prefer that theory to a peremptory assumption of guilt. There, there, sweet niece, do not be downcast. Madame understands how these things can happen. Do you not, madame?
I do, monsieur.
There, we have heard enough. Madame de la Rougière will be your companion at the utmost for 3 or 4 weeks. You will do well to get your French up a little.
Why, sir? Shall we be going to France?
I'm sending Million before you to the conventual school. It's a project I've had in mind for some time now. If the school is satisfactory, which Madame assures me I have every reason to expect, I thought you might find it a pleasant change to go there for a short while.
I understand then, Monsieur Tutin. You wish I shall resume my instructions.
Converse all you can in French with Madame Maud. You'll be glad when you get there. You'll find they speak little else.
And will Millie be improving her French as well?
One cannot augment what one has never had.
Madame, I will not speak with you.
Do not be so childish, Maud.
You know my reasons.
I confess I do not.
You said I was lying. You said in front of my uncle I was lying.
I have my reasons. If you knew my reasons, you would praise me.
We will have none of your wriggling.
You fool. I was trying to find some papers concerning Dr. Brierly. I think he is after your money.
You have never met Dr. Brierly.
We have talked about him.
It is you. You who are after my money. You were trying to find my father's will.
What a pathetic and ridiculous creature you are.
You hate me. You wish me harm. You always have.
Such cruel words. When I am proved right, then you will thank me.
Mary, what am I to do? What am I to do?
And now, Miss Moore, don't worry yourself about...
Frightful woman. Will I never be rid of her?
You must not give yourself over...
I must be collected in front of them. Today I fainted. That was unwise. It's only with you I can give vent to my feelings. Oh, Mary, Mary.
Hush there. Hush, hush.
What is the true relation between Madame and my uncle? Did she come even to Noel at his instigation? Did she already know Dudley when I first encountered him? Indeed, was she his accomplice?
You should not bother your head with such fearful fancies.
On the contrary, Mary. If I am to see my way through this, I must embrace them. Madame spies upon me and meddles in my affairs. Madame spies upon me and my uncle refuses to believe me. Dudley tries to abduct me. Why? To obtain my fortune.
Well, how would he manage it?
I do not wish to dwell on that possible course of action. Dudley tries to abduct me and my uncle refuses to believe it. Dr. Brierly represents my interests. He clashes with my uncle. My uncle refuses him contact with me.
Miss Maud, are you suggesting...
Dudley proposes marriage to me. As my husband, he would have total control of all my affairs. Dudley proposes, and my uncle refuses to hear my answer. It will, of course, be no. My uncle refuses. My uncle refuses. My uncle refuses. Now I ask you, to what does all this point...
You're too young, Miss Maud, for such thoughts.
I tell you, Mary, these last 8 months, I have aged.
The next morning, I was sitting with Mary Quince reading.
Oh, well, see ya! Oh, you well, can't. See ya! Miss Ruth, eh? Miss Maud, Ruth and of Noel!
Lord bless us!
Let me see that jezebel!
You can't go in there, I tell you. You can't!
Where is she?
Don't go, miss. She sounds drunk.
I am Miss Ruthin of Knoll. Who wants to see her?
I tried to stop her.
Get me back my lawful husband.
I beg your pardon.
Get me back my lawful husband. I know he's here. He said he's dumped me. He's taken up with you, but I ain't having it.
I assure you, I have no intention of marrying.
That's not what he says.
And who is your husband?
Read this.
Marriage at Leatherwick Church by the Reverend Arthur Hughes. Dudley A. Ruthin, Esquire of Bartram Howe.
Derbyshire to Sarah Matilda, second daughter of John Mangles, Esquire of Wigan in this county.
It's in the paper, so it's official.
Dudley A. Ruthin, Esquire.
I demand you produce me husband.
This is extremely important. You must see Mr. Silas Ruthin this instant. I am certain he knows nothing of it.
No more he does. I know that myself.
Come.
What is all this?
This lady has brought with her a newspaper containing an extraordinary statement which affects our family.
A libel, I suppose?
No, Uncle. No. Only a marriage.
Thank you. Ugh. Smells all over of tobacco and beer.
I'm only claiming what's mine by rights.
And I shall make sure you get it.
You are, I suppose, the young lady, Sarah Matilda, nay Mangles, mentioned in this little paragraph?
I am.
My son is, I dare say, within reach.
Sir?
Yes, Wyatt, how prompt. I want my son immediately. If not in the house, send Harry to the stables. If not there, let him be followed, instantly.
Very good, sir.
What does your esteemed father do?
He minds wagons, sir, for the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railway.
I see he is in the van of progress.
15 minutes later, Dudley arrived.
Oh, Dudley, Dudley, oh, Dudley, I could you. Your own poor Sal. You could not, you would not. Your own lawful wedded wife.
Get off me, woman.
Dudley, you would not abandon me for...
Pray, madam, command yourself. If only for a few moments. Thank you. Judging by your looks and demeanour, sir, I can anticipate your answers. Is this young person the daughter of a Mr. Mangles, and is her name Sarah Matilda?
I dare say.
Is she your wife?
Is she my wife?
Yes, sir. It is a plain question.
Well, happen she says I am, does she?
Is she your wife, sir?
Mayhap she so considers it after a fashion.
What do you think, sir?
I don't think nought about it.
Is this account true?
Who wants to deny it? It's true, there.
There, I know he would. I know he would.
Shut up, will you?
Dudley. Dudley, darling, what have I done?
You're going to ruin me, just, that's all.
Ah, I knew it, of course. And I have to congratulate you, my good fellow, on having secured the affections of a very suitable and vulgar young woman.
I ain't the first of the families that's done the same.
You say that? You say that to me? Why, boy, I'll whip you till...
You touch me, I'll smash you, by heaven I will.
Does he know what he's saying?
You may jaw me all you like, but you won't touch me.
Oh, I may speak. Thank you. I may remark, without offence to the young lady, I don't recollect the name Mangles among the old families of England. I presume you've chosen her chiefly for her virtues and her graces.
You're very kind, Sheila.
I hope she's got a little money. I don't see how you are to live else. You're too lazy for a gamekeeper, and I don't think you could keep a pothouse. You're so addicted to drinking and quarrelling. The only thing I am quite clear upon is that you and your wife must find some other abode. You shall quit this house tomorrow morning. And, Mr. and Mrs. Dudley Ruthin, you will quit this room now, if you please.
Come, will you? You're pretty well done here.
Good afternoon, Miss Ruthin. Mr. Ruthin.
Come, will you, cuss?
Maud, how shall I recover this? The vulgar villain, the fool... For me, the last hope gone. For me, utter, utter, irretrievable ruin.
He's sending me away, Maud.
I know, Millie.
Tomorrow.
The same day as Dudley.
I'm to go on the train to London with a doctor's wife, and then on a boat.
I wish Madame were going back with you.
Don't worry. You'll be joining me soon.
Do you think so?
What do you mean?
We never got to Elverston to visit Cousin Monica.
No.
What do you think of your brother?
Dudley? He's a stew.
Miss Maud! Miss Maud!
What?
Over here!
Meg!
Oh, tell her to stand aside.
Millie.
I heard. We never were friends, were we, Beauty?
You're your father's daughter.
I'll be over there.
What about your father?
He mustn't know I'm talking to you. He's had instructions. You're not to be let out of the grounds. They're closing the gates. There'll be dogs.
Why?
I don't know.
You're risking a beating telling me this.
I owe it to you.
Thank you.
I must get back to Father.
When can I leave?
Meet me here tomorrow at the same time.
She's gone.
She's wild.
Like you used to be.
You can't trust her.
I think after nursing her, I can.
You can't trust her.
I may have no other choice.
My dear Ward, I feel I owe you a fuller explanation than you have hitherto received. And I see by your silence you feel entitled to be offered one.
As you wish, Uncle.
Within 3 weeks, there will be an execution in this house.
An execution?
I did not intend to alarm you.
What is an execution?
How blessed are the paths of innocence. I lie a mangled creature with 50 mortal wounds on my crown. I am heavily, possibly terminally, in debt. Within 3 weeks, my creditors, or rather their bailiffs, will arrive and distrain my property. They will probably seek to distrain me also. I shall have to escape if I am to maintain my liberty. That is why I have arranged for you to go for a short while to the convent to avoid all this unpleasantness.
How deep is the debt?
I fear you will recoil. I tell you frankly that less than £20,000 will not extricate me from the quag of ruin in which I'm entangled, lost.
And if I were to find a way to release you from your difficulty, my resources are ample, as you know.
Niece, I cannot accept money from you.
Why not?
The difficulty, the insuperable moral difficulty, is this. That I should expose myself to the plausible imputation of having worked upon you unduly for this end. You understand my scruple? I am seriously thinking of vacating my guardianship. Indeed, in the circumstances, it is improper of me to maintain it. I think Lady Knollys would be an admirable candidate to take it over.
Uncle!
I perceive you agree with me. I would ask you to write to her to explain what has passed between us this evening. My predicament and your departure to France. Your offer and my scrupulous reasons for rejecting it. My larger scheme and my hopes for her place in it. You will do that?
I should be delighted, Uncle.
It will bear all the more weight coming from you. I only ask that you let me see the letter tomorrow morning, say, so I can confirm it has accurately communicated my intentions. That is not too much to ask?
I shall bring you the letter tomorrow morning.
Yes, you have become so sensible.
Uncle?
My dear Maud.
Why have you given instructions for the gates to be closed?
So the execution cannot come upon me unawares. Why did you think?
That night, as Mary Quince lay sleeping, I wrote 2 letters to Lady Knollys.
My dearest cousin, this will be the 2nd letter you receive from me.
The 1st was the one my uncle asked me to write.
The 1st is about going to France, money and the guardianship. What it says on the surface is, on the surface, true. It has, however, been read by Uncle Silas. The 2nd is this one, which has not been read by him. Do not ask how it has got to you. Oh, my beloved cousin, as you hope for comfort in your hour of fear, aid me now. Madame de la Rouchière has appeared. She is here, and my uncle insists on making her my close companion. She is of his party and has been all along. He will have my money. He has tried every legitimate means, but to no avail. I do not understand his current stratagem, France and the rest, but I fear, I dare not say what I fear. The gates are closed against me. There are dogs. I do not know to what extremity my uncle will go. Take me away from this. If you insist, he cannot refuse. For God's sake, take me away.
The next morning, I took the other letter to my uncle.
My dear Maud, how clever you are. You have conveyed exactly what I intended.
It has been my pleasure, sir, to do so.
I shall see it is conveyed into the post.
I shall leave you, sir.
Yes, of course, of course. Oh.
Sir?
My errant son and his unfortunate wife. They will be sailing from Liverpool tonight. They have decided to emigrate.
Mary Quince, we were not overlooked, leaving the house.
Not that I saw, miss.
I neither. Here, she said.
Who said?
Meg Hawks, Beauty from the mill. I must ask you to stand guard.
Where, miss?
Over there, That commands the path.
Yes, Miss Maud.
If you see anyone approaching, you are to call, I found it.
I found it.
That's right. Meg! Meg!
I'm here. Miss Maud.
I cannot say how relieved I am to see you.
Have you not been sleeping?
Why do you ask?
Your face. Your eyes.
I need your help. I need your help more than I have ever needed help before.
What is it?
Do you know anybody who... Do you know anybody who can get a letter out of Bartram without anyone? Anyone knowing?
Your cousin Millie, she's...
The doctor's wife will be with her all the time. Besides, it must not be posted. It must be delivered direct.
The letter is to go to Lady Knollys at Elverston.
How did you know?
She is your lifeline. Tom! Tom!
I'm coming.
Tom Bryce?
He'll do as I say.
Why?
Don't ask, miss.
I'm here.
It's as I said, Tom.
You knew I'd...
What else can you do? He'll take it, Miss Maud, if he can. Won't you, lad?
Yeah, I'll take it.
Tom Bryce, you won't deceive me.
No, sure.
No.
You won't betray me.
No, sure.
A great deal depends on this.
That's true for her, Tom.
I'll give you a sovereign now, Tom. And you are to give this letter to Lady Knollys at Elverston. You know Elverston?
He knows Elverston, don't you, lad?
I'm not stupid.
And I'll give you another one when I know the letter's got there.
That'd be very good.
You'll take the letter, Tom.
Yeah, I'll take the letter. Thank you, miss.
Tom, if you can't be true to me, say so. Say so and keep the sovereign and say you won't mention this conversation.
I don't want to cheat you, miss. But I must take care of myself, you see. The letters all go through Silas' fingers to post. And if this one turned up, they'd all know it went beyond and I'd be spotted for it.
But you know who I am. I'd save you.
You'd want saving yourself, I'm thinking, if that fell out. I'll do what a wise lad may, miss. But I won't get knocked on the head nor sent to jail, for that's no good to thee or me.
I understand, Tom.
Come what will, miss. You'll not tell her me.
What, you're going now, Tom?
Never you mind, lass.
Yeah, that's it. You'll get into the sheep walk behind the mound.
I've
and then
found
you'll...
it.
Oh, well done, Mary. Quick, go.
It was over here all the time.
I never thought I'd see it again.
What's this?
It's Samuel Hawkes from the mill. Good morning, Mr. Hawkes.
Have you seen my girl?
Meg?
Happen?
Why, no. Not all morning.
I thought I saw Bryce about earlier.
Good morning, my dearest Maud.
Madame, I have made my opinions more than plain. I have no wish to talk to you.
But you must be so lonely.
I am used to my own company.
Both your cousins having left yesterday, one for La France and the other for l'Australie.
I assure you, I can look up...
Leaving you with only your old, stupid maid. See what I brought to amuse you.
Madame...
Your uncle wishes me to be with you.
Does he?
See what I brought to amuse you. The globes, just like we had at Knoll.
I recall you did not understand them,
The globes of the world, from England to Australia. And see here, the newspaper. And see here, in the shipping list, the Seamew leaving Liverpool today to Australia. And who is this in the passenger list? Mr. and Mrs. D. Rutin, bound from Liverpool to Australia. Every day the paper will tell us where the Seamew has been sighted, and every day we can plot it on the globes. There, Liverpool. I will mark it so. Will not this be diverting? Where is your dear cousin today? Let us see. The Seamew sighted off Brest. Brest, I know, and here it is on the globe. You are not interested in Dudley's progress?
Yes, yes, very interested.
I shall mark it here. And where is your dear cousin today? Let us see.
Madame.
The sea mew sighted of La Rochelle. It is making progress.
Madame, would you please stop?
La Rochelle I also know, and here it is on the globe. You are not interested in Dudley's...
No, I am not interested in Dudley's... I wish him a safe and speedy journey, that is all.
You surprise me. I thought his progress would divert and also help your geography.
I am sure it will do both those things. But do we have to every day go through this?
André!
The governor wants to see Miss Maud.
How far today do we think Dudley to be?
The ship was sighted off La Rochelle.
La Rochelle, yes.
I don't think you have summoned me here solely to make that inquiry.
No, no, quite so. I'm writing to Lord Ilbury, your trustee.
Dr. Brierly is the chief executor.
No, I'm not writing to him for reasons we both know. I'm writing to young Ilbury about the proposed transference of responsibilities to Lady Knollys.
Yes, Uncle.
Naturally, I want to give some indication of how you have seen my guardianship.
Yes, Uncle.
I wish to say you found me kind, considerate, indulgent. May I say so?
Yes, Uncle.
I also wish to say you enjoyed our poor way of living here, our rough ways and liberty. Am I right?
Yes, Uncle.
And in fact, you have nothing to object against your poor old uncle except his poverty, which you forgive. I think I'm saying the truth. Am I, dear Maud?
Yes, Uncle.
That is satisfactory. So I expected you to say. I expected no less. Then how do you account for that? There! Young hypocrite and liar. Explain that farrago of slander which you bribed my servant to place in the hands of my kinswoman, Lady Knollys. As you hope for comfort in your hour of fear, aid me now. He will have my money. He has tried every legitimate means, but to no avail. I fear. I dare not say what I fear. I do not know to what extremity my uncle will go. To what extremity do you think I'm going? What does your vicious heart conceive that your mealy mouth will not utter? You do not answer. I used to think you were a frail, slight thing with no experience of the world. I used to think your mistakes were the result of an ignorant innocence. You thinking you'd been hounded by my son at Knowle. You thinking Madame was trying to steal your father's will. She is young, she's confused. Let us think nothing of it. But now I see things in a different hue. Everywhere you go, you sow confusion and dissension. Where'er you walk, you build your empire by charm and guilelessness, and then you swoop. You suborn my servant, you slander me. I have sent my daughter away lest you corrupt her. Why is she doing this, I ask myself? What is her plan? Is it deliberate? And the answer comes, no, it is not deliberate. She knows not what she does.
I will not faint.
You are mad. I am forced to the conclusion. You are mad.
I will not faint.
And I shall cure you.
I will not faint. Mary. Mary.
I'm here, Maud.
What day is it?
It's Sunday.
Was it only yesterday my uncle revealed the letter?
It was.
I did not faint.
You did not faint.
What is the matter with me? Why can't I remember leaving his room?
You became very quiet. You would not speak.
I did not faint.
No. Your eyes were open. You could hear people.
Then what?
Your uncle called me and I led you here.
I feel so weak.
You are weak.
He must have had the letter for 2 days. Why did he delay revealing it, letting me think Cousin Monica might... I have answered my own question. He said I was mad. Am I mad?
I don't know what mad people are like.
He is deliberately wearing me down.
You are still the same Maud to me.
And we are in his hands. My last lifeline gone.
My dearest Maud, I hear you are ill. I am so concerned. I have come to sit with you.
Madame.
My sweetest Maud.
I am too tired to take issue with you.
Madame, what have you done with the key?
What is that, Mary Quince?
The key to the bedroom door. After you came in, you locked the door and pocketed the key.
Did I? Oh, yes, here it is.
Why are you locking us in?
Locking you in? I'm locking the other people out. Little Maud, your uncle is still very angry with you. We would not like him coming in and spoiling your sleep, would we?
It was to lock us in, for later I found Uncle Silas was receiving a visitor.
My dear, dear Monica, how very good of you. The very person I long to see.
And where is Maud?
I think Maud is by this time halfway to Elverston. I persuaded her to take a drive and advised the call there, which seemed to please her.
How very provoking.
My poor Maud will be sadly disappointed. But you will console her with another visit. You won't deny me.
Oh, certainly not. I'm only too glad to come. And I have to thank you, Silas.
For what?
For wishing to place Maud in my care. I am very much obliged to you.
I did not suggest it, I must say, Monica, with the least intention of obliging you.
But I am very much obliged to you, Silas. And you shan't refuse my thanks.
I'm happy in having won your goodwill. We learn at last that in the affections only are capacities for happiness. And how true is St. Paul's preference of love, the principle that abideth.
Is Maud likely to return soon?
Certainly not before 5 o'clock. Hmm. You'll probably meet her on your way back to Elverston. Goodbye, my childhood Monnie.
Goodbye, Silas. Strange.
What is?
No, nothing.
Whose is that carriage?
What carriage, dear?
Let me see. It is the physician, Dr. Jokes. He has come to see your uncle.
I heard a woman's voice.
No, my dear. There is only the doctor. He has come to see your uncle. I tell you, he is getting out of the carriage.
The carriage is driving away. It's Lady Nullis. I'm here.
Stop it.
Cousin Monica.
Stop
for
this.
Sake.
You must
stop
this.
Cousin Monica. Cousin Monica.
What are you doing?
Save me. Let save me. Oh, here. Cousin Monica. Save me.
See what you have done.
You hurt her.
She is mad. Did you not hear her uncle say so? She is mad.
June tipped over into July. My sense of foreboding increased.
Why are you so ill at ease?
I'm surprised he lets us out for walks.
You must build yourself up again.
For what? The gingerbread cottage? How does he know I won't run away?
You can't.
No. The mill's working.
What's she trying to get you to do?
There's Zamiel Hawks. The brute.
Are you certain, like?
Was that with him?
Oh, it's just a bit of chaff.
They've gone in.
It's just a bit of chaff.
Angels and ministers of grace. It's Dudley. It's Dudley that's with him.
Oh, nonsense, girl. He's somewhere off Portugal.
Day after day, I paced the corridors of Bartram in solitary agitation. Time after time, I was drawn to Mr. Chark's room, but I did not dare go in it.
I will not do it.
You have no choice.
It isn't in my line. I can't.
No one likes this sort of thing, but what else is there to do?
It won't work. We'll be caught.
You've no choice. The old boy's behind you with his pitchfork and his tail. You can't stop now.
It's the old boy, Nick, or you.
Besides, it will work. It's worked before. Watch.
And where is your dear cousin now?
Good morning, Maud.
Good morning, sir.
Maud, we have had words, but let us forget that for the moment. I will speak plainly to you. I perceive you are in danger.
Uncle?
You are in danger on 2 counts. The first is that the execution I mentioned will be upon us in 2 days. So I am informed by my attorneys, Messrs. Archer and Slay of Buxton.
It can only be distressing for you.
It is not the first time. The second is the more important. I'm gravely concerned for your health. You have overstretched yourself, and I can only think the associations you currently hold with Bartram Howe, for whatever reasons, cannot be conducive to your recuperation.
Sir?
I had always intended you join Millie at the conventual school in France. We shall advance our plans. You will leave in an hour's time.
Leave Bartram Howe?
Leave Bartram Howe.
Oh, sir, I cannot thank you enough.
My dear Maud, although we have our differences, I have your interests very close to my heart. I have given instructions for packing.
Will Mary Quince...
You will be accompanied to France by Madame de la Rougière. You will recall that was the original plan.
I would prefer it if...
Does Mary Quince speak French? Remember, Madame is not a lady's maid. During the journey, she is in my stead. You will do as she directs.
You know the antipathy.
It is only for 2 days. Mary Quince and I will follow directly. I shall be lodging close to you. You are pleased?
Why, yes.
I would ask a small favour in return.
What is it?
I would ask you to write 2 letters to our cousin Monica. The first, now, explaining what is happening. My creditors. We need not mention your health. It would alarm her needlessly.
Yes, but...
You will explain you cannot put the French address in case the bailiff should find it out.
I understand.
And she can communicate via Messrs. Archer and Slayer of Buxton. The second will be written whilst you are at London. It will say you are satisfactory upon your journey, which indeed you will be. You will show the first letter to me and the second to Madame.
Uncle, I resent the implication.
I must know you are not libelling my character. You have done so once. We understand each other now, but you are fickle. You will write the first letter now.
I don't know if I can.
I shall expect it in 15 minutes.
Your uncle says he's sorry he can't say goodbye.
Come along, Maud.
He's a touch of the old trouble.
Thank you, Wyatt.
We shall lose the train.
I'll hand you up, miss.
Thank you.
There you are. You've made your fond farewells with Mary Quince. I thought you would never come.
Drive quickly. The train departs in 19 minutes.
Hop!
I've had so many pleasant visits to your country. I look forward to showing you mine.
Madame.
Dearest Maud.
I think it would be best if we spoke to each other as little as possible.
So, you are quite recovered.
I would also be grateful if you address me as Miss Maud, at least in public.
Here are the gates. Open up! Open up!
Morning, Miss Maud.
Good morning, Hawks.
I hope she has a pleasant journey.
Thank you, Hawks.
Hop!
I have never been in a train before.
It is a great big dragon, and it eats little girls.
I have never seen so many people.
It is nothing to Paris.
Last confession to railway murder. Last confession to railway murder.
Is the young lady looking for somewhere to lodge?
She is with me.
Oh, sorry. Didn't recognise you.
Look at the monkey.
There. Hold it, ladies. Hold
it. Oh, look at his arms.
Take it off me.
Here, my man.
Much obliged.
Spare a penny for my chair.
Look, we must give something.
Nonsense. This is how she makes her living. She is rich. Is not London wonderful?
I think it is hell.
Last confession for railway murderer. Bullet tells all.
So, we are settled. Mrs. Sewell is an old friend of mine. I have stayed here often. You are tired?
How do people sleep with the noise?
I must go out. My dear friend, Mademoiselle de Saint-Eloi, lives just across the street. She is bound to be in, and she will be offended if I do not call on her.
Whatever you wish.
You will write your letter to Lady Knollys.
Yes.
You will do it properly. I will inspect it when I return. I will not be long.
My dearest cousin, I am writing to you from London. I am much tired by the journey, but... Come in.
I hope I'm not disturbing you.
Mrs. Sewell.
Mrs. Ruthing. And I hope the room's comfortable.
Yes, yes, comfortable enough.
You've
Not been to London before?
No, I have not.
And you're going to France?
Yes, to a convent school.
A convent school, yes. I have known Madame for some years.
So she informs me.
She stayed here with a number of young ladies while escorting them to France.
To a convent school?
To convent school, yes. I used to escort young ladies myself. Well, that's how I met Madame, but now I run this hotel.
Mrs. Yule, what is it you want?
Oh, I wanted to say I'm here if you need me.
Of course you are. You run the hotel.
I run the hotel.
The next morning, as we were at breakfast...
Entrez!
A letter for you, Miss Ruthie.
Fool! It is for me.
Oh, miss?
What is it?
It is from your uncle. There.
My dear madame, be so good as to take the 8:30 train to Dover tonight. Beds are prepared. Yours very truly, Silas Ruthin. Why is Dover underlined?
Or should I know?
Has it not a meaning?
How can I tell what was in your uncle's head when he made such a mark? In you get? Here we are. Safe and sound.
Is this the station we arrived at?
No, it is the one for Dover.
How long will the journey be?
Some hours. Now, compose yourself and get some sleep. Maud, wake up.
Madame.
Maud, wake up. We are at Dover.
Carriage for Miss Ruthin.
Come, we shall be late. We are now in the hotel grounds. Will you stop over here? Are you awake, Maud?
Yes.
Here we are. I have often stayed here.
I'll hand you down, miss.
Thank you. Where are the boxes?
I told you, they will follow.
It is dark.
It is late. Come. In we go.
Why have you locked the door?
They only left it open for us.
Where are the lights, madame? Where are the people?
It is 3:00, child, but there is always light here. There. We can see our way. Let us go to our room.
But where are we to go? There is no one.
Never mind. They know me here. And I always have the same room when I write for it. Here we are. This is my bed, and that, by the window, is yours.
You've locked this door as well.
I always do in hotels. It is safest, and I put the key in my pocket, like this. Now, let us sleep.
Will they wake us up in time for the packet steamer?
I have no doubt of that. Good morning.
Yes.
Have you slept well?
I'm still tired. I'm not used to travel.
I am refreshed.
We're not too late for the packet.
We have another 2 hours.
Have they brought in the water?
Not yet.
We should go down to breakfast.
I will get them to bring it up here.
Is there a pretty view from the window?
No.
Can we see the sea?
No.
What's the view like?
Why don't you open the curtain and look out?
So dirty. This hotel... Is it a hotel? Why, this is just like the inside courtyard at Bottom Hall.
Well, Miss Maud, is it not a clever trick?
We are at Bottom Howe.
Yes, 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 yes.
It
is a mistake, is it? What is it?
All a mistake, of course. Bertram Howe is so like Dover, as all philosophers know.
Well, madame, I suppose you will be able to explain this to my uncle.
Never mind. I think he will forgive me.
You have brought me back, then, by my uncle's orders?
Did I say so?
What is the object of this duplicity?
Duplicity? Duplicity.
I suppose I may go to my own room.
Not today. It was disarranged when we went away.
Where is Mary Quince?
Mary Quince? She has followed us to France. I will go to talk to your uncle and get Miss Maud some breakfast. My dearest little Maud. My sweet little creature.
The windows. Screwed shut. The wainscoting has been pulled off. This was Mr. Chark's room.
Miss Maud.
Oh, Meg. I thought you were Madame. She's been gone for hours.
They gave me some food to bring you. I've got you this instead. It's only bread and water, but...
It's safe.
Don't eat anything they give you. And drink only water. They intend to kill you.
I am convinced they do. Give me your key.
I can't. I must give it back to them.
Let me go out with you.
They're watching.
Can you get to Elverston?
They won't let me out of the house. After Tom Bryce.
Tom Bryce? Does Madame know they intend to murder me?
I don't think so. Father says they haven't told her everything. She drinks too much. She might have told you.
Yet they tell you.
They don't think I care for you. I must go. They'll be wondering.
Meg, Beauty. Goodbye.
Don't say that.
Madame.
I am sorry, my dear, to be so long. I had business downstairs. They do not tell me. Oh.
What time is it?
Just after 4 o'clock.
As I thought.
You have been fed?
I am not hungry.
She is not hungry. She is not hungry. She is not...
Madame. Madame, I am frightened.
But what of?
Save me! Save me!
This is unseemly. Save you from what? There is nothing to save you from. Un moment, s'il vous plaît.
Yes? Master has sent some spiced wine to Miss Maud.
Thank you, Wyatt. Your uncle has sent you some wine. Will you try some? It smells good.
No, no. I'm not thirsty.
Very well. You will be glad to hear you will be rid of me tonight. I shall be sleeping downstairs.
No, I am not thirsty.
I notice they do not send anything for me. I will try some of this wine. Ah. Your uncle may be about to be ruined, but he does have good taste.
I watched, hypnotized, as she drank and drank and drank.
Oh, my dear Maud. My child, that never was.
Gradually, she became drowsy. She lay down on the bed beside the window and finally went to sleep. O'clock at least. What's that? The courtyard.
Nearly finished. This should do it.
They are digging my grave. Past 1 o'clock.
She's asleep. By the window.
I know!
Do it! Do it! Now! Is it done?
Yes!
It was done quickly. Now back through the window and close it from the outside.
It's the wrong wand!
What?
It's the Frenchie! It's the wrong wand!
Wait! Let me see.
It's the Frenchie!
And I ran and I ran and I ran. I've escaped. I'm alive.
Miss Maud.
Tom Bryce. I'm lost.
I'll take you to your cousin at Elverston.
You will?
I will.
But the letter...
I got caught. I had no choice. Get in!
And now to endings. Tom Bryce delivered me to Elverston, where I flung myself on Cousin Monica.
Oh, Maud, Monica.
It had been my uncle's plan to pass me off as having died in France and claim my estates. In the event, Dudley and Zamiel buried Madame in the grave intended for me. Zamiel Hawkes fled to Wigan, was later found guilty of an heinous crime, and paid the ultimate penalty. My cousin Dudley was never seen again. My uncle Silas was found dead in his room, an empty bottle of laudanum by his side. Meg Hawkes and Tom Bryce married, and are doing well. My cousin Millie...
Oh, Maud.
...and I were joyfully reunited. She is now a clergyman's wife in Derbyshire. Dr. Briley is my close and faithful friend and runs my estates. Mrs. Rusk and Mary Quince, though 8 years older, are with me still. And I too, am 8 years older, and married to Lord Ilbury, of whom you might have heard mention.
Shall I bring Ilma through, Maud?
We are very happy, having all we could ask for.
Here he is. Who's going to his mother, then?
But still, in the back of my mind, there is a shadow. A shadow from 8 years ago, which is upon me still.
The blood of the Ruffins. The finest blood in England.
In the final part of Uncle Silas by Sheridan Le Fanu, Maud was played by Teresa Gallagher and Silas by George Cole. Madame de la Rougierre, Dorothy Tutin, Lady Monica Knollys, Joan Sims, Mary Quince, Kathleen Byron, Millie, Jane Wittenshaw, Dudley, Jonathan Keeble, Zamiel, George A. Cooper, Beauty, Becky Hindley, Sarah Mangles, Linda Regan, Wyatt, Pauline Letts, Tom Bryce, Roger May, the coachman, Stephen Critchlow, Mrs. Sewell, Joan Littlewood, Dr. Brierly, John Hartley. Other parts were played by members of the cast. Uncle Silas was dramatized for radio by Alan Drury and directed by Enid Williams.